The eyes of Texas are upon you.
Oh, the live long day.
The eyes of Texas are upon you.
You cannot get away.
Do not think you can escape them.
From night to early in the morning.
The eyes of Texas are upon you.
Till Gabriel blows his horn.
Here come the Texas Longhorns running into Memorial Stadium with a record of 9-2, 5-2 in the Big 12 Conference, and ranked 10th in the nation, still hoping for an at-large bid and an invitation to the BCS. Darrell K. Royal Texas Memorial Stadium is sold out. Capacity crowd, more than 80,000 strong for one of the great rivalries in all of college football. And hello again, everybody. I'm Tim Brand, along with Ed Cunningham. Glad to have you along for what is a terrific rivalry and senior day in Austin. And speaking of Austin and Texas, they have one of the best known players in all of this country.
And unfortunately for Chris Sims, with that big name came big expectations. And the team has not won a championship, either national or conference, since he's been here. And he's heard about it his whole career. But the talk around town all week has been, let's be supportive of this senior in his last game. Got a great ovation a moment ago. Not going to be easy today, though, against a defense of Texas A&M that's been banged up all year long, but the one thing that they've done is gotten after the quarterback. And with Ty Warren, their best defensive lineman, questionable with a high ankle sprain, Gerard Penright, outside linebacker, will be blitzing all day. Key to this game, keeping Chris Sims on his 2 feet.
Now, the man who has had to be a rock this week, the emotional leader of the Aggies, is head coach R.C. Slocum, and he's with Sam Ryan. Sam?
That's right, Tim. Coach, it's been a tough week for you and your team. What did you tell them in the locker room to get them prepared for this game?
Well, it has been a hard week, and I told them the best way they can honor Brandon Fales and his memory. He loved his university, loved being a part of this football team. For them to go out and play with great pride today and give great effort in this game. I understand Brandon's mother and father are going to be watching the game, and I won't them to know that our thoughts and prayers are with them, even in up to the kickoff of this game. This is important, big game, but nothing's as important as the feelings we have for the Fales family, and we're going to go out and try to give a good showing in honor of Brandon Fales.
That's right, R.C. Thank you.
Thank you.
Tim.
A tough way to start the day, to start the week. Anytime. This game has been called a backyard brawl, but it's more like a protection of pride and a soul-searching spirit. Texas won the toss and deferred. A&M will receive the opening kickoff. We're underway in Austin. This is Bethel Johnson trying to get outside across the 20. Johnson to the 30 and all the way out to the 33-yard line. So Texas A&M started the season with 27-year-old Mark Ferris at quarterback. Today, Dustin Long is the starter. So let's meet him in his own words.
I'm Dustin Long from Port Neches Groves High School. It's Port Neches, Texas. I set the Big 12 and school record for most touchdown passes in a game.
Dustin Long is a 6'2 sophomore and the only Aggie quarterback to play every game this year. He's capable, folks. He threw for a record 399 yards against Kansas and 7 touchdowns against Texas Tech. First down, A&M. Sack. It didn't take long for big Marcus Tubbs, 95, 6'4, 305 pounder, to get his third sack of the year.
Marcus Tubbs, a guy who had a strained calf, didn't play much against Texas Tech. They had the week off, and Carl Reese, the defensive coordinator, said we really needed that time off to get some guys healthy. Kalen Thornton, a defensive end, has had a banged up ankle after a knee injury last year. Tubbs has amazing ability, and they look forward to big things from him in the future.
Second down, the Aggies need 17. Long rolls, throws. And it's complete to the 40, but short of the first down. It'll bring up third down and short.
Now let's take a look at our AT&T Wireless starting lineups. Backs and receivers, Derek Farmer's the starting running back. Bethel Johnson, the deep threat. Jamar Taylor's a possession receiver. He's hobbled with a sore knee, flat tire. A&M's offensive line is one of the main reasons this offense has caught fire the last 8 weeks. It's young. Yates is the only senior. Allen Ruber, who started when Yates was hurt, starts today for Brooks, who's banged up. Third down and two. Farmer, the setback, he's the carrier. Makes a cut, should have the first down, and does. They'll move the chains. On the carry. Texas has one of the stingiest defenses in the country. Up front, they are physical with speed. Corey Redding is the disruptor. C-Red has a sack in six straight games. The linebackers are solid. Derek Johnson is the leading tackler. Reed Boyd is the heartbeat. And in the secondary, Basher and Babers are the corner cover guys. They'll challenge it, too. Huff and Pearson are the safeties. And Texas ranks eighth in the country in scoring defense.
There's a look at Derek Johnson, a big, smooth linebacker. Great speed, just a sophomore. Co-defensive freshman of the year last year in the Big 12.
On first down, it's Farmer. Off left tackle, not much. Still got a tough three or four.
Take a look at the numbers of Texas A&M offensively against Texas defensively. And the key today is going to be the ball in the air. Texas A&M, for people who haven't seen them play this year, after game three when they only scored 3 points against Virginia Tech, R.C. Slocum made a change in his staff, and he promoted wide receivers coach Kevin Sumlin. He gave him the play calling duty. Sumlin, who came up under Mike Price, and Joe Tiller likes to spread it out four and five wide all the time.
Second down and seven. The completion, the first down, and there's our first look at Greg Porter, who's a big-time receiver, folks. 46th reception of the year. Second nationally in receiving yards among tight ends. Gain of nine.
And he is such a good route runner. Here he's lined up in the slot in the trips receiver set. And a lot of times, that time he had over-under double coverage, and teams have to do that with Porter, although he's not the fastest guy. He runs great routes. And, Tim, I don't know that I've seen a guy in the last 10 years who has better hands than Greg Porter.
Weber and Farmer in the eye. First down, Aggies. Farmer hit immediately. There he is, folks, Corey Redding. One of the four finalists for the Lombardi Award. He is in all everything, defensive end, and his motor always runs. A loss of four.
He's a guy who came in. He was the 1998 USA Today Defensive Player of the Year as a linebacker. Came here, put his hand on the ground. He's been playing defensive end ever since. And if you're Texas A&M, you might want to get a hat on this guy. He went completely unblocked. There was on the right side a missed assignment, but even when he's blocked, he makes a lot of plays.
Second down and 14, the draw. Farmer runs into C-Red again. Gets back to the original line of scrimmage, plus a yard.
The other thing that Corey Redding does for Mack Brown, and Mack Brown just thinks so much of this young man and his leadership abilities. He said, if there's anybody in practice in games that isn't ready to go for us and isn't going hard, he'll whip him. He will literally go over there, grab him by the face mask, and get him going. He's been a great leader for Mack Brown for 4 years.
This is the most prolific offense A&M has ever had. The first unit in school history to pass for more than 3,000 yards. It's third down and nine, and they need a completion now. Picked off! Derek Johnson with the interception. And DJ may have pulled something on the return, but it's all the way back inside the 45. They'll mark it at the 44, and DJ has the Longhorns rolling.
And he's bothered by a hamstring, Tim.
He's more than bothered now. Watch this.
Yeah, right in the middle of your screen, and long, it's so hard. You know, when you're a quarterback, you're looking a lot of times beyond, and boy, he's not even... I don't know if he's going to be able to finish, Tim. I mean, that looked like when he caught it, he could have got much better field position than he did. So he pulled that hamstring at Texas Tech. He looks awful.
So the pick, the return of 25 yards, and now you give Texas a short field with Sims at quarterback. Play action. Why not? Incomplete. Well, we get our first look at a very capable Texas offense, starting with the Longhorn quarterback. So let's meet him in his own words.
Chris Sims, Ramapo High School, Franklin Lakes, New Jersey, 14-0 as a starter at home. Just trying to keep that streak alive. I want to say good luck to the Ramapo Raiders in their state championship game in 2 weeks, too.
All right, Chris, he's a 6'5", 225-pound senior, 24-6 as a starter, and he ranks first on UT's career chart for completion percentage. Checking off. And that doesn't make the home crowd very happy. Ran out of time. 10:53 to play in the first. A&M in Texas. And this backyard brawl is always fun, anytime, any place. But DJ has the Longhorns in pretty good shape here. Austin, Texas, Longhorns with the ball after the interception by Johnson. Second down for the Horns. This is Benson around the left end. Tackled by Appel, but a pretty good pickup for Cedric Benson. Our AT&T Wireless starting lineup. Benson, quick, elusive, physical back. Rushed for over 2,000 yards in the last 18 games. Quality receivers in B.J. Johnson and Roy Williams. You add Sloan Thomas to that mix, and it could be their best trio ever. Offensive line is big, averaging over 300 pounds. Derek Dockery is 345. Bo Baker starts for the injured Tillman Holloway. They lose some girth there, but still very good, solid offensive line. Third down and one, Texas. Benson, first down. Moore, big hole inside the 25.
Well, and Bo Baker just pounds away at that left side. He is in there because Tillman Holloway sprained his ankle against Texas Tech. Watch the left side. That's the left guard. Baker, a senior, does such a nice job passing off the nose guard, getting up to gamble the middle linebacker and opening a huge hole for such a diverse back in Cedric Benson. He does so many things well out of the backfield. He's great in blitz pickup.
First down, Texas. Here he is. Benson has nowhere to run that time, maybe a yard. Defensively for Texas A&M, an aggressive, hard-hitting 3-4. Ty Warren is the senior leader, but he's banged up, so David Ross got the start. This defensive line is combined for 10.5 sacks. As always, A&M's linebackers are the heart and soul of the defense, led by Gerard Penright, who has 8 sacks. And in the secondary, Byron Jones and Davis, they are the corner cover guys. Keel and Appel, the safeties. Terrence Keel is one of the most underrated strong safeties, I think, in the country. Second down and 8. Sims, 3-step drop, has it blocked. Big old Linus Smith got his hands up. He's 6'4.5", and he knocked it away.
Take a look at Texas offensively, statistically against A&M's defense. And this defense for A&M, those that yards a lot higher than we're used to seeing with the Wrecking Crew. But in all fairness to R.C. Slocum and his staff, Mike Hankwitz, his defensive coordinator, it's and R.C. said it, it's comical how many injuries that they've had to overcome this year.
Third down and 8. Folks, right here, here's your matchup to watch. Tall receivers against short corners. And Sims knows about the mismatch. But here comes pressure. Chris Sims in trouble. Now throws. And incomplete. Great pressure by the Aggies defense. And Randall Webb came through almost untouched.
And this is an all-out blitz. Safeties and linebackers, all one-on-one coverage. And if you're going to do that, you have to get there right now. Safety Appel comes, and then Randall Webb is the guy who's chasing him down. Webb's been so active from that inside linebacker spot with 7 sacks on the year. But you come all out, you better get the quarterback on the move like A&M did there.
Let's see, Mangum comes in for the 37-yard field goal attempt. And from this distance, he's only 3 of 7. This one, however, plenty of distance and splits the sticks. But there is a flag down.
Well, it's on A&M. They're asking Texas what they would like to do.
Looks like Byron Jones is the man that is the guilty party.
Don't take
running
the points
into
off
the kicker.
Board.
The penalty's declined. The field goal is good.
All right, so Randy Crystal, our referee, gets us all squared away. The field goal is good, and the Texas Longhorns are on the board first. So it was all set up by the interception by Johnson. He returned to 25 yards, gave Chris Sims a short field to work with, and then the 37-yard field goal by Mangum. It's a 3-0 game with the Texas Longhorns playing at home and having the lead. Crowd here at Darrell K. Royal, Texas Memorial Stadium. The Longhorns on the board, 3-0. That's where we are. Still early, 9:27 to play, first quarter. Richmond McGee to kick off. Jason Carter is deep and will take this at the goal line. Carter tripped up at the 12. Terrific play by Brent Robin. Let's go downstairs. Here's Sam.
Well, Tim, an update on Derek Johnson. You see he's back out there right now after making that pick. He had the trainers check him out. His right hamstring is a little tender. This is the one that he injured in their last game. Little tender, as I said, but he will play. He's back in the game. They're just being cautious right now. Guys?
And, you know, he's a speed guy. When we talked to him the other day, he tries to outrun people as much as take them on, especially linemen. This could really affect his game if he's that hobbled.
When he's healthy, one of the best linebackers in the nation. Farmer, big hole, fumbles the football. Ball still loose. Texas got it. Dakare Pearson came up with it. And once again, here come the Longhorns after a turnover. Roderick Wright forced the fumble, and Pearson got it.
Roderick Wright, a true freshman who earlier in the year got his first start because of an injury to Marcus Tubbs. And he never let go. Boy, that ball got hit right on the point. That was actually Cedric Griffin, freshman strong safety, who put his helmet right on the ball and popped it out.
Have to wonder how squared away Texas A&M could be after this week they've had. First down, Texas. The reverse. This is Williams, and he's taken down for a loss. And now a flag comes in. Good coverage by Terrence Keel, second leading tackler in the safety, but there is a penalty, and it may be a face mask.
Terrence Keel is sure a tackler, as there is in college football. When he gets around you, and Roy Williams went to stiff arm
him. 5-yard face mask. Be enforced from the previous spot. It'll be a 5-yard penalty, first and five.
Roy Williams gets just as much of the face mask. That's legal. That's the right call. He had a little piece of the bottom. The offensive player is allowed to put his hand on the defensive player's face mask as long as he doesn't grab it when he goes for the stiff arm. But, boy, that was a nice tackle by Keel. Texas has been so good all year with turnovers. And with the 3 points they got off to Derek Johnson, they're plus 79 points on the year and looking to add to that.
Benson goes out. Selvin Stoney Young comes in, the true freshman. Here he is. Great burst. Back to the line of scrimmage, and that's it. Myron Jones made the tackle. Not the way Texas A&M had hoped to start. Wanted to use this game as a diversion, get their mind off the travails of this past week, the tragedy. As you look at Mike Hankowitz, the defensive coordinator.
Well, they come out and they've played hard, but you know, Dusty Long did not see Derek Johnson, the linebacker, underneath. And then just a very nice hit on the ball by Cedric Griffin. Puts R.C. Slocum screw in a bad spot again.
Tripped up, good play at the line of scrimmage by Marcus Jasmine. So maybe a pickup of a yard. Actually, they gave him a great mark.
Well, he's that fast.
Oh, man.
Selvin Young.
Quicker than Gossip.
We saw him when we did the Iowa State game, and Mack Brown has said that this freshman class, which Selvin Young is a true freshman is part of, is the best class that he's brought in. And when you think of the years of recruiting that Mack Brown has done since he's been here, that's saying a lot. Chris Sims' class with him and Corey Redding, that was a great class. But, boy, they have some guys in this class that have Texas set for a really nice future for the next 3 or 4 years.
Well, the final home game for those 24 Longhorns, as you see how far. All of them recruited by Mack Brown and his staff, and all of them successful, as you said, posting a 25-6 conference record through four seasons. Phenomenal.
Well, here's a spot where Greg Davis on second and an inch. If I'm Mike Hankowitz, a defensive coordinator for an A&M, I better get some guys ready to look. Roy Williams coming down here solo.
Are they going to play like this, short yardage defensively? You got to guess.
Yep. No, if I'm Texas, though, why not take a shot here?
You got to establish a new line of scrimmage a yard deep and get a fill, and that's what they did. Sims won't get it. Defensive line has to submarine and establish a new line of scrimmage a yard deep in Texas side of the line of scrimmage. Let the linebacker fill. That was perfect short yardage defense. Ty Warren in the game with a nice job.
You know, Ty Warren, they didn't even practice this week, and he had great leverage on that play. Nice and low. Boy, that's really good pad level by Ty Warren. And the key is, don't just dive into the ground. You got to stay up a little bit.
That's as great a short yardage defense as you'll see right there. But they need to do it again because Texas is going for it on fourth and one. Going to try to draw him off. A&M holds fast.
Why not go for
delay.
It?
It's a 5-yard penalty.
Well, now they're going to have to kick down. It.
Well, that's all they wanted. They didn't have a play called. They were just trying to draw them off with a hard count.
A smattering of boos from the burnt orange fans, and I don't blame them. Why not go for it? You've got the momentum. You've got great field position even if you don't get it.
This would be a terrific stop if A&M can do it. Dusty Mangum, who's 1-for-1 today, now with a 41-yard attempt. And from this distance, he's 3-for-5 on the year. He's got the leg strength. Good snap, good hold. And he splits the sticks. A 41-yard field goal. And with 7:02 to play in the first quarter, the Texas Longhorns lead the Aggies 6-0.
Only two turnovers and only 6 points, though. Texas A&M has to feel good about that.
.702 to play, first quarter, scoreless on the Texas A&M side. But if you look at the Nissan Drive summary, 4 plays, 4 yards, took just over 2 minutes after the turnover and the 41-yard field goal, his second of the game for Mangum, and it is 6-0 Texas. Richmond McGee to kick off. He'll bring it out. Byron Jones breaks a tackle across the 20, still on his feet at the 25. Better tuck the ball. He lost it. Texas has it. Third turnover for A&M.
Tim, I've never been a fan of defensive backs returning kicks for this exact reason. Byron Jones, a sensational cover guy, sophomore, had 3 picks in the bowl game last year. But watch, you said it. Watch the ball get away from his body as he's running. He's got to keep that ball. Oh, boy, what a nice job from behind. Stripping that ball out. Aaron Harris knocks that ball out.
But now you have to wonder how much life is in the legs of the A&M defense. The defense which has held Texas to only one first down, and Sims hasn't completed a pass. He's 0-for-3. Here he is. There's the completion. DJ Johnson has a pickup of 8. It'll bring up 2nd down and 2.
But the reason that it scares me when you use a defensive back in returning kicks, as we take a look at Sims' first completion, is because they just don't handle the ball every single day, all day during practice. I mean, you work on it during special teams, but those guys are not used to squeezing it high and tight up against their shoulder pads.
Benson, the setback, the workhorse. Here's Benson looking for a hole. Can't find one. Short of the first, it'll be close. I don't believe he has enough. Tripped up again by Terrence Keel, second leading tackler, and a underrated strong safety. Boy, he makes sure the secondary has the right calls. He's active. Again, I'll tell you, I think, folks, Keel is one of the most underrated strong safeties in the nation.
Well, and they're going to need him right here because, once again, Texas A&M comes out defensively and making Texas earn it after a turnover.
Third down and one. Benson. Hit immediately, depending on the mark. It's close. Jared Morris, the linebacker, tattooed him. Met him in the hole and flat out stoned him. But he may have had enough.
Boy, and you mentioned, Tim, you didn't know about the Aggies, their legs defensively. If they keep having to go out and defend the short field, the injuries, Jared Morris is just coming back from a banged up knee. He had surgery during the offseason. He struggled with it all year. At one point during the Missouri loss, Mike Hankwitz looked out and he said there was only four guys who originally started the game that were finishing it for us.
I guarantee you they'll go for it this time.
Yeah, they have to.
Crowd really trying to influence Mac Brown.
And don't even mess with it. Get behind Jason Glenn there at the center. You've got a 230-pound quarterback, 6'5", Chris Sims. Let him stretch the ball out.
No hesitation this time.
No.
Offense didn't even leave the field. Didn't even look to the sidelines.
And you said it a moment ago, if you're the defense, you know, sometimes you guess.
Okay.
Go on one. Take a risk.
Here we go. Less than a yard. Fourth down. Short yardage defense. Benson and Williams are setbacks. Benson. First down to the 15. He was almost gone had he kept his feet.
Well, the A&M defense has been playing with their back up against their own goal line so much at the beginning of this game. The Derek Johnson interception. And when the ball knocked out, Derek Farmer was just a great tackle. And then a defensive back who doesn't handle the ball all the time gets a little squirrely with it and gets it knocked out from behind.
RC's kids on the ropes. Benson trips back to the line of scrimmage. Randall Webb again was there. Texas A&M will blitz you only about 24% of the time overall, but in third down, nickel maybe 42%. So they don't blitz all that much, but on third down, there's that possibility.
Well, and that's what the 3-4 defense allows you to do. Because when you bring an outside linebacker, it's not truly a blitz because then you just have four rush and the quarterback and the running backs and receivers have to all be on the same page as to who is coming and who you consider a blitzer and not a blitzer.
Second down and 10. That wasn't a blitz. He just came through, beat his man. And again, it's Marcus Jasmine, who's 6'4", 317 pounds, big, strong, consistent defensive lineman, and he's a hole clogger.
And all, listen, if you're going to have one-on-one blocking, you got to win up front. And Jason Glenn, oh, that was slide protection. His left guard, Bo Baker, they were sliding to the strong side of the formation, and his left guard, Bo Baker, did not come down. Jason Glenn expected some help, and Marcus Jasmine does a little swim move over the top, brings that left arm over, and because the guard's not there, makes a sack.
So advantage, Texas A&M defense. Third down and 16 for Sims. Here's the pressure again. Sims throws underneath. And the Aggies converge on him. It won't be enough for the first. Ivan Williams gets down to the 10. They'll mark it right around the 10, but he'll be about 5 yards short of a first down. And so the field goal unit will come back on.
And this time, you know, you mentioned that A&M doesn't blitz a lot until they get in a nickel. That time, no blitz at all. And Chris Sims had nowhere to go. They dropped seven, covered up all the zones, and he just takes the safe play and dumps it off. But again, A&M defense, they've got to be happy with what they're doing after three turnovers.
So here's Dusty Mangum again, this time from 28 yards out. 2 for 2 so far. He's perfect. But you have to believe, three turnovers and only 9 points, these are victories for that A&M defense.
R.C. Slocum, a defensive coordinator. He's been at A&M for 30 years, started as a defensive assistant and a coordinator. And Mike Hankwitz and his defensive staff have been tested all year with injuries. And in a game that so much emotion is riding on, 3 turnovers and 9 points, that's unbelievable. They've got to feel good about themselves right now.
Well, this A&M team has been on an emotional roller coaster. Had that big win over top-ranked Oklahoma, lost to Missouri in double overtime, then the death of Brandon Frales, and now Texas. I can't imagine more of an emotional roller coaster than these kids have been through in the last 3 weeks. .241 to play, first quarter. A glorious day in Austin, Texas. A little overcast, temperature in the mid to upper 50s, headed to around 60 degrees. So McGee to kick off. It's Thomas and Johnson that are deep this time. This will be Johnson. Back to the 17-yard line and tripped up by Aaron Harris. Take a look at our Tostitos BCS standings. Miami still unbeaten. Ohio State has locked a spot in the national championship game. And there's Oklahoma, which lost to A&M. Tell you, the team I wouldn't want to play right now is USC.
Nope,
Carson Palmer.
Doubt.
And there's Texas at number 9. We mentioned at the top of the telecast they lost to Texas Tech, and that was devastating. Took them out of the national championship picture.
And they would have been right in there with Oklahoma, Iowa, and Georgia. Those one-loss teams just becoming huge Syracuse and Virginia Tech fans now.
But the BCS tells us that Texas is still alive for an at-large bid to the BCS. Coming up next, Big 12 North champs Colorado take on Jamal Lord and the Huskers, who are out to avenge last year's loss. Full day of football, that's coming up next right here on ABC Sports. Colorado's playing well.
Yeah, Chris Brown got a little sternum bruise. I don't think they're going to be able to hold him out of that one. Larry Johnson took over the lead in the rushing race with that 279 in the first half last week.
Second down and 7. First down, Aggies, goes Joe Weber. They use him mostly in goal line as a blocking fullback, but he picks up 10 here and has the first.
And this is what you do to an aggressive defense. And Marcus Tubbs, who, boy, he's in a lot of pain.
Well, he came into this game with a sore calf muscle.
Yeah, and he pulled it against Texas Tech, wasn't able to finish that game.
Big, big man, Marcus Tubbs. 6'4", 305-pound junior.
A lot of excitement. Obviously, Texas wants to finish out this season strong, go to a nice bowl game. But with only 3 seniors in their 2 deep defensively, one of the nation's top defenses this year, will be awful tough to contend with next year.
So he's up on his feet. Stevie Lee comes into the game to replace him, so they pick up 5 pounds. Stevie Lee, 6'4", 310, and just a sophomore. He's a pup.
And Lee's a guy that they really, he needs to turn the light on. You know, he's got all the great ability, but the coaches need to see it every day on the practice field. And he's one of those guys that if the light ever goes on, he's going to be an All-American.
What a combination Texas has defensively. A physical defense with speed.
Well, and you're starting to see, you know, the college game kind of mimicking the NFL game. You get those big, big 320, 330-pound defensive tackles, and then you get like guys like Derek Johnson, who aren't as big as physical as a middle linebacker that you'd want, but they can run around because they're hiding behind those big anchors in the middle.
First down, Aggies. Dustin Long has a man. Complete down to the 30 goes Jamar Taylor. Taylor got behind everybody. He's playing with a knee sprain, but still got behind the secondary.
And he got behind a senior because Rod Babers bit on the fake. Look at Babers peeking in and sat right on it. And, you know, good cornerbacks like to be able to see the quarterback so that they can try to make a play on the ball. And sometimes when you take a risk like that and take your eye off your man in man coverage, he's going to run right by you.
A gain of 39, first down, Aggies. And you have the feeling that A&M needs a score really badly. Here's Weber. Weber's loose. First down, down to the 10. A&M has really been good in the red zone, scoring 90% of the time.
And all they're doing is a little delay to the backside. It's kind of a counteraction because Dustin Long goes to his right, and Weber ran this exact play about three plays ago. Might as well go right back to it.
Mark him at the 13. First down and 10. Weber again around the corner. Rod Babers knocks him out after a gain of about one.
And Weber, a former running back, he's been moved to fullback this year, 233 pounds. But last year he rushed for nearly 500 yards. So he's kind of one of those diverse guys that can block when you need him to and run with it effectively. And that's the one thing Kevin Sumlin said. We don't have to be great running the ball as a throwing offense. We just have to be efficient when we do it.
Second down and 9. Play action. Throws underneath. Has it complete. This is Thomas. Touchdown A&M. 12-yard run by Thomas after the catch. Terrence Thomas, a 5'9", 174-pound sophomore from Houston, Texas. Just drifted, found that open space, and then scored.
What a nice job by Dustin Long. He was looking for Porter the whole way. They had him double covered. Came all the way back to his second read and found him standing wide open.
Todd Pegram's extra point attempt is good. So the Aggies gig him a little bit. And now trail by only 2.
Boy, and A&M's defense needed something like this. They've held up their end of the bargain after 3 turnovers, 2 on offense, 1 on special teams. But Dustin Long, the one thing that A&M, once they, Mark Ferris was their starting quarterback earlier in the year, not a very athletic guy, relied on his arm. But with Reggie McNeil, who's out with a severe sprained ankle that he suffered against Missouri, and Dustin Long, you have athletic quarterbacks that can run around and make plays with their feet while they're waiting to get somebody open.
You know, Thomas is so tiny. I lost him at about the 4.
Dustin didn't know. That's the key.
He became a hide-and-seek runner. He was hiding behind the big guys, was seeking the end zone, and he found it.
Well, and where he was hiding was right in there with the linebackers, and Reed Boyd, who was in zone coverage for Mac Brown. That's a huge mismatch in quickness.
Just like on cue, the Aggies score and the sun comes out. 6 plays, 82 yards. Didn't take a lot of time off the clock. 30 seconds still remain in the first quarter.
And the Aggies defense, barring a great return, and Texas, one of the best return teams in the country, might actually have some field to defend.
High kick, short kick. Basher at the 5 with a hold. Flag is down. Basher back to the 30, but there is a flag at the 19. Nathan Basher has speed, so when he finds a crease, you hold your breath. This will be against the Longhorns and back him up.
No. Gotta take it now. Gotta drive
Basher, one of the best punt returners in the nation, had a touchdown last year, none this year. He's been battling an ankle. He sprained it against North Carolina and aggravated it last week against Texas Tech. Nearly, there was a huge hole, and now we know why.
Is there a more hospitable host?
Holding
no.
on the receiving
Brown?
Team.
No, what a great
it's
man.
It's a 10-yard penalty, first and 10.
You know, you sit with him, and within 5 minutes, you want to sign on the dotted line and come play for him. I mean, he is just a good-hearted man, and he knows what R.C. Slocum's going through because of what they went through with Cole Pittman.
Had a Thanksgiving brunch yesterday for the players and for a lot of kids who were not fortunate enough to have their own, and to boost spirits, invited everybody to that Thanksgiving brunch. Selvin Young is now the tailback. First down, Texas. Boy, that A&M defense getting after it. Terrence Keel again. He's got five tackles already in this game.
Playing a little close to the vest because of the penalty. Backed up to their own goal line, Texas. But if you want to get Terrence Keel out of the mix, you're going to have to start getting Roy Williams and Sloan Thomas and B.J. Johnson involved, because Keel, he just becomes an extra linebacker, and running is going to be awfully tough.
That's the end of the first quarter. The Horns lead the Aggies by 7. Our presentation of college football will continue after this message and a word from our ABC stations. The backyard brawl is on. It's more like a protection of pride, folks.
God bless Texas. I've been sent to spread the message.
So we start the second 15 in Austin, Texas. 9-7, Longhorns leading the Aggies. Sims rolls left, throws, has it complete. Short of the first down, ball's loose. And the whistle blew. You know, aside from Chris Sims, the only legendary Bobby Lane has started 4 straight years as a Longhorn quarterback against A&M. Hey, we asked Mac Brown about Chris Sims because he's taken some hits here in Austin.
Well, he's 6'5", he's 230, he's got great ability, he's got blue eyes, he's great looking, he's rich, he's fast, he's going to be in the pros, he's smart. They're jealous. Everybody's jealous. Guy today is the third winningest quarterback in the history of the storied Texas football program for 109 years. What a great career he's had at the University of Texas.
Amen to that, Matt. He ranks number one here in Texas in career completion percentage, too. And a quality young guy, Chris Sims, fun to be around.
And I promise you this, and a lot has been made about his interceptions in big games, and he's had some rough ones. The Big 12 championship game was tough. Texas Tech earlier, 2 weeks ago. But when you see him, and yesterday when we were spending time, and the way he has built his arm, he's going to go to the combine, and he's going to wow the NFL scouts. And a team's going to see his ability. And I bet he gets drafted a whole lot higher than people think he is.
As if that loss to Oklahoma last year wasn't enough, somebody gave out his cell phone number. Disgruntled fans loaded it up. So by the time he hit the bus, he had some messages. He's hit hard here. Sammy Davis came on a corner blitz and just flat out leveled him.
Well, you mentioned earlier when we talked to Greg Davis, the offensive coordinator, he said, you know, A&M on regular down and distance, they're less than a quarter of the time do they blitz. And this time, Sammy Davis, the candy man, comes in from his corner, and Sims never expected him to blitz. You could tell that Sims didn't think he was going to see a blitz that time, and Davis disguised it to the last possible second and took a big shot up around the head of Sims.
Johnson and Williams come to the bottom of the screen. Benson, the carrier, fights his way ahead for 3 or 4. Boy, he set a bucket full of freshman records, preseason All-America. He's been on the Duke Walker list. 6 feet, 205-pound sophomore, Cedric Benson.
His productivity down just a little bit. Yards per carry from last year. Change up of the offensive line. But, you know, he had a really bad turf toe that's still not 100%.
This Aggie defense shutting him down pretty good, though. 8 carries, 35 yards.
This Aggie defense is playing great right now.
Brett Robin comes in to take his place. Ace formation, 3rd down and 6. Drills it. 1st down, Williams. Out of bounds at the 34. Roy Williams.
Boy, this is
the 55th catch of the year.
Boy, this is a tight fit throw by Chris Sims. Drop 8 by A&M. I don't know, you count them. That looks like triple coverage to me on Roy Williams. There was trips to that side. And dropping 8, and you're going to have to surround a guy like this. 6'4", 230. He's built more like a linebacker than he is a wide receiver. But that was a nice throw by Chris Sims, fitting that ball in there.
Gain of 11, 1st down. Sims again throws, has it complete. And again, Williams.
Sims fast to
picks up a couple of tough
Williams,
yards. They
Davis.
Call him the Prince. And Roy Eugene Williams is the real deal. He can play. 6'4", 210 pounds. He'll be at the next level.
A guy that big, he long jumped nearly 26 feet in high school. I mean, this is a sensational athlete. Oh, Sammy Davis, a little banged up. All the injuries A&M's had in their secondary, then this is their best cover guy, first team all Big 12. They need him trying to cover that big man.
Thought this secondary was going to be one of their strengths coming into the year, but it has really been hit, as you mentioned, by injuries this year, now severely depleted. Second down and seven. Benson breaks two tackles and carries it to the 41-yard line.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned the injuries for A&M. It has been comical. The words of R.C. Slocum, he said, it's been ridiculous what we've had to go through. The backups in the defensive secondary, they lost every single second-string secondary player for the season. And the starters that have been hurt, Jackson Appel, bothered by a groin. Ty Warren, we didn't expect to play today. Davis, concussion. He's back on the sidelines right now. At times, they've only had five original starters on the field that they started the season with back in August.
Third down and four. Sims throws a strike again to Williams. Three in a row to Roy Williams. One of 10 semifinalists for the Biletnikoff Award. They love him here in Austin.
Well, the one thing Greg Davis knew, noticed when he was breaking down film was that Texas A&M doesn't play as much squat man press coverage. They're not up in your face as much.
They can't. They've lost their real talent.
Well, and you know, Sammy Davis a little banged up, but that's the problem of trying to defend Roy Williams. If you get up in his face, he can run right by it. If you give him space, he's big enough to shield you and pick up 6-7 yards at a foot.
Selvin Young to the 45. Into A&M territory. He's extremely quick, smart with a burst. Just a true freshman, was playing high school ball this time last year.
Well, and he's one of those guys that has, he's worked his way onto the field as amazingly talented as Cedric Benson is. The coaches saw very early what this young man had, and Greg Davis says he's so quick, we have to get him a little more patient reading his blocks. He tends to run into the line and not let things develop, especially in zone-type blocking plays.
Sims started the game 0 for 3, but now he's gone 6 for his last 7. Well, not much there. David Ross with a pretty good tackle along with Johnny Jolly.
And, you know, here's what Greg Davis was talking about. And I played with a guy at the University of Washington who was a freshman when I was a senior, Napoleon Kaufman. And it used to be so exciting for us when we'd be blowing somebody out to get to see him run. But the one thing that Selvin reminds me of Napoleon is they have so much ability that they think they can just stick it in there. That was a time where maybe if he just puts on the brakes a little bit and then he can cut it back.
It's a big third down and three here. Coming on a blitz. Texas picks it up. Johnson still on his feet. Look out. B.J. Johnson's loose. Touchdown Longhorns. 44-yard score. Up by Sims and a terrific run by B.J. Johnson.
A little drag route. Can't miss tackles.
Dusty Mangum perfect on the year with 44 for 44 PATs. Make it 45. An impressive drive by the Texas Longhorns. 10-02 to play in the half. 16-7, Texas. B.J. Johnson's run has made it a 16-7 Longhorn lead with 10-02 to play in the first half. Thomas and Johnson are deep. Johnson will take this one at the 12. Should have good field position. Gets a block out to the 33-yard line, and now a flag comes in late. On that Texas drive, Chris Sims, 5 for 6, 74 yards. That after starting 0 for 3.
Hey, give him time.
Holding against the Aggies.
Holding, return team, 10-yard penalty, 1st and 10.
Well, if you give Chris Sims time, he will pick you apart. And an all-out blitz. Watch Selvin Young pick up Jackson Appel. Now, he should be close to the line of scrimmage at the block. But that's a true freshman. That's one of the harder things to teach those young guys how to do. Been carrying the ball all through high school. But he gave a great pocket for Chris Sims to come back down to the drag route to BJ.
A&M now has to respond. Farmer almost breaks it out to the 30. First down Aggies. Derek Farmer, he's really the only true tailback, but he's been hurt quite a bit this year. Averages 4 yards a carry, 663 yards for the season.
And you go all the way back to last year, he had a hyperextended knee he was fighting. He's got the bad shoulder this year. He's such an explosive back. As a true sophomore, I'd really like to see what this young man can do with a full year being healthy, because he has that little bitty burst in the hole.
Well, as banged up as he's been, he's still only the 6th sophomore to join the Aggies 1,000-yard club. Absolutely nothing there for Farmer that time. Now it's time for our Aflac trivia question. And this week's trivia question, I think, is going to stump you. Who's the all-time career rushing record, or whose all-time career rushing record did Ricky Williams break in 1998?
Took me 10 minutes and a hint last night to get that one. I was embarrassed.
Had nothing to do with the grape. Second down and 9. Long steps in, throws underneath, has it complete to Johnson, who's loose. And Johnson goes out of bounds at the 42. First down, gain of 13. The Aggies' all-time leading receiver in both receptions and yards, Bethel Johnson.
And he comes all the way across the formation. And it's such a good route. You know, it's tough to run because it takes forever for the receiver to get all the way over there. But a lot of times, it's almost impossible to run with a guy that far in man coverage. But in zone coverage, you lose sight of him. And Dustin Long had time. And, boy, I tell you, Dustin Long making his 9th start of the year, and then Reggie McNeil came in. He's really impressive. He has a good command
timeout
of the offense, and he does not get flustered when his first, second receiver aren't open. He just keeps going through his progression, and his feet don't get choppy. He looks really calm in the pocket.
Dustin Long takes a timeout. That's the first taken by A&M. 8:36 to play in the first. Timeout on the field. We'll take one as well. City of Austin, Texas, 80,000 fans here today. I was surprised how many little kids and families were in the hotel last night on Thanksgiving, enjoying their Thanksgiving meal there.
What do you think, they're going to miss this thing?
Ready for the game. First down, Aggies. Farmer taken down from behind. And I mean, Corey Redding was like shot out of a cannon.
Oh, he's a finalist for the Lombardi Award, and kind of like Larry Johnson made his late season run for the Heisman, Corey Redding has been absolutely unstoppable. The last 6 ball games, he's had a sack in every one of those games. Such an athletic guy, gained about 35 pounds to go from being a high school linebacker to a defensive end, but he still runs like a linebacker.
A lot of people forget that great recruiting class of 99. Sims was the number 1 quarterback. Redding, number 1 defensive player. Here they come again. Adam Dorian along with Byron Pickroll. A&M's going backwards. A loss of 10.
And Dorian in there because Marcus Tubbs was hobbled with that calf strain. Had to get helped off the field earlier. And they are so active with their front 4. Carl Reese gets kind of spoiled when they're healthy up front, and they haven't been. They at one point had to play 3 down linemen against Texas Tech, not because of the passing game, but because that's all they could put on the field. But when they can get pressure with their front four, you are in trouble.
The draw. Absolutely nothing as Joe Weber trips over the 30-yard line stripe. So after what looked like it was going to be a pretty impressive drive and took the ball all the way up to the 42, A&M started to go backwards with solid defensive efforts from Texas. Cody skates to punt. He's a pretty good one. And he'll be punting to Nathan Basher, who is very dangerous. This is Basher at the 19. Breaks a tackle and slides to the 25. So a 49-yard punt and a return of six by Basher.
It didn't eat much time off the clock for A&M's defense. Seems like they've been on the field the entire one and a half quarters to start this ball game, and the way that Chris Sims was slinging it around on that last drive, they could really start mixing some things in, pounding Cedric Benson, getting BJ and Sloan Thomas and Roy Williams, get them going vertical.
A&M's defense definitely needs a stop. Appel shakes and fakes a blitz. Now they throw. Look out. It's Williams. Roy Williams is gone. UT's career touchdown record holder scores his 25th. It's a 75-yarder, and nobody was going to catch him. Texas threatening to blow it open.
Boy, and you mentioned Appel blitzing right before the snap, faking a blitz. He got himself completely out of position on that slant.
Mangum's extra point attempt is automatic. Wow. The Prince can fly, and Sims threw him a strike.
Well, you know, you try to show some things that you're not going to do. Appel is 3 yards off the line of scrimmage, and the slant's going to come right into the zone where he should be backing into, and he gets out late. See how late he is getting out there? And I believe Byron Jones, who's in coverage, was expecting the safety to be there. Appel was faking blitz, going out to cover the flat instead of helping inside. See, Byron Jones has outside leverage. He's on the outside shoulder of Roy Williams. He had to have been expecting Appel to be there, and Appel thought, I'm up near the line of scrimmage. Sims reads it perfectly. You try to disguise it, but boy, you better get back to your assignment against a senior quarterback.
And with Williams' speed, he knows if that defensive back is on his hip, he says, if we're even, I'm leaving. He can pull away from anybody.
Although he's not quite 100%. He's got that hamstring he pulled against Houston. He said yesterday, I'm 99.3%. And Greg Davis has said, you know, he's fought all year to try to get healthy, but every now and then there's that deep ball that you're used to Roy Williams going to get. But with that little twinge in his hand, he hadn't been able to really stretch it out.
Well, folks, this place is hopping. And the Aggies need something big. Fair catch is called. Thomas Carragher, the tight end, makes the fair catch, and I don't know why. So impressive. Look at these numbers. It's hard to figure why, but he is one of the most underappreciated guys in college football, in my opinion.
Well,
he's a winner.
Well, there's been a couple of those games, Tim. I mean, you can't put it all on him, but he's had some struggles in some big games.
Part of the problem was that 99 recruiting class came in so heralded. Everybody anticipated and expected a national title game. When they lost to Oklahoma, everybody jumped on him as being underachieving. And I don't know if that's the case. A little while ago, we asked you the Aflac trivia question. Whose all-time career rushing record did Ricky Williams break back in 1998? The answer is...
TD.
All the way back in the 70s. Tony had 6,082 yards.
And Bevo, he couldn't care less. He wants to know where his next meal is coming from.
Bevo's serious. This game is serious. Second and two for Long. Throws deep. He's got a man and overthrows him. It was intended for Jamar Taylor again, and Taylor, just like earlier, had a step on the DBs.
Now, Dustin Long had to get rid of that because he was taking a shot right in the face as he was letting it go. And this is a big conversion right now for A&M. Boy, is he athletic. He's going out there against Derek Farmer, tosses him aside, but you can see how nimble he is. He is going to wow NFL scouts when they come for timing day and test his agility. He can really move.
Third down and two for Long, and you're right, they need one badly. He's in trouble, throws a tough pass, and what a catch! Bethel Johnson had to reach and dive and extended himself as far as he could to make the catch on his fingertips.
You know, Jamar Taylor earlier in the year made a comment that was kind of taken out of context by the Texas group. And he said, you know, our group of receivers, Bethel, myself, Terrence Thomas, and you got to throw Porter in there, the tight end. He said, we're as good as there are in the country. And everybody in Texas said, oh, we've got better. But you know the one thing, the A&M receivers, time and again, and watching their film, these guys have great hands. They catch balls all the time that you think are going to be incomplete.
Farmer with a big pickup. I'll tell you something else, too. He's not far from wrong. I don't think he should have backed off his statement. And although this could be the best trio of receivers Texas has ever had, A&M, when you think about Porter, Johnson, Murphy, and Taylor, all have at least 31 catches and are averaging at least 17 yards a grab. They've combined for 37 plays that gain 20 or more yards. It's a talented, talented group.
Well, and that's the group that Carl Reese, the defensive coordinator from Texas, said, I'm so worried. You know, Greg Porter's a great tight end. We can kind of contain him because he can't run by you. He said, I'm really concerned about Taylor and Thomas and Bethel Johnson because they can just flat run by you. And we just saw what kind of hands Johnson, we saw Porter earlier.
Blitz, got him. Jerod Penright with his ninth sack of the year. Penright leads the conference in sacks. I said Penright. I'm thinking Penright. It's Thornton, of course.
Number 43 is all over the field for both teams. Thornton, who had knee surgery last year, he's been banged up a little bit this year.
He really played well. Yeah. He played well against Oklahoma. Thornton's been playing really well the last three games.
And they're getting pressure with their front four. That was a blitz, but it's Kalen Thornton, the defensive end, who made the play.
Third down and nine. They're not going to get it. Murphy is tattooed. Rod Babers with the tackle. Let's take you back to New York City, John and Terry. All right, fellas, thanks. This putt is down to the 21-yard line. That's where it'll be down, almost at the 20. So a 39-yard punt. That's where Texas will have it. You talk about Bear Bryant, R.C. Slocum, and Gene Stallings, and they've had some terrific. Danax, Bible, Aggies have had some great coaches. 2:58 to play in the half. We'll be back. Texas A&M with three turnovers and the Longhorns lead 23-7. And UT getting the ball back.
Well, and right now, Chris Sims and Roy Williams are putting on a show. And A&M's tried everything, bringing blitzes and mixing up coverages, but Sims is really on his game.
Texas has scored on every possession. Five times. Here's Sims. Steps up, throws deep. Incomplete. Let's go downstairs. Here's Sam Ryan. Sam, what do you got?
Well, Tim, I found the bravest guy in the house, Cliff Kingsbury, Texas Tech quarterback. His team beat Texas. His team beat Texas A&M. And the fans recognize you, Cliff.
Yeah, I'm taking some views, but it's my friend's last game here, and I want to come support him.
That's good friends with Brian Gamble. Now, talk about the Texas game. That was a huge blow to Texas. But how big of a win was it for you guys?
It was big. I think, you know, to beat both the teams in our state was huge for the program, and hopefully we can build off that.
The Big 12 passing leader, talk about your season.
It was fun. You know, we had some great wins and you know, some big numbers, so I had a good time.
Congratulations, Cliff. Thank you.
Well, I'll tell you what, Cliff Kingsbury has a rifle hanging from his shoulder.
Well, talk about big numbers against these two teams. He threw for nearly 1,000 yards and 11 touchdowns. And he can only stay till half. I wonder if he's got a date with Britney Spears after the ball game.
There's his buddy. I'm Gamble. Let me ask you this. How do you think Kingsbury does at the next level?
Oh, I think, you know, a lot of people are going to say, oh, it was the system. And that may be true to an extent. But a guy who he's so smart and he sees the field so well that he's going to command an offense very quickly.
Sims is sacked. There's a flag down at the 13-yard line. Randall Webb got at him first.
Well, and you try to get your athletic guys. You got Jonathan Scott, the right tackle, working one-on-one with Randall Webb. And watch the inside move. When you have a guy 220 pounds going up against a 300-pounder, you got to use the quickness. What great pad level, too.
While being holding.
And Randall Webb, boy, he just got a great jump on the ball, dipped his inside shoulder.
You make that penetration while you're being held, that's something.
And I like the timeout here by A&M as well.
Wrecking Crew has 40 sacks on the year. They will put pressure on you. Mike Hankwicks has an aggressive, talented group, but as you mentioned, Ed, they are dinged up. He's thin. 2:09 to play. 23-7 Horns. We'll be back. First punt of the afternoon for Texas. Brian Bradford, a punt. You're looking at Bethel Johnson back to receive it at midfield. High end over end kick. It's not particularly long. It hits. This is Johnson at the 45, the 40. And A&M's going to have the ball with 1:56 to play in Texas territory.
Take a look at the Pacific Life game summary. Dustin Long finds Terrence Thomas, who fights his way into the end zone. And then B.J. Johnson working on Byron Jones, who misses the tackle, gets a good block from Roy Williams. And then it's Roy Williams and Chris Sims have been connected today. Boy, they really have found a rhythm. Sims has stuck the ball in a couple of times in a tough spot.
A 37-yard punt, 6-yard return, and A&M's got good field position with 1:56 to play in the half. Long with time, throws, complete. Murphy down close to another first down. Terrence Murphy.
Well, and you know, you've got to have a little pace to your offense, but you don't have to be rushed. You have a minute 50 left. The clock stopped right now to move the chains. You've got one timeout in your hip pocket for A&M. So be deliberate. Don't take your time, but be deliberate and make sure you have the call you want in.
This is the number 2 passing offense in the Big 12. First down, Aggies. 5-step drop. Long's got pressure, throws, complete. And again, it's Murphy.
Well, you want to get up there. Get set. Like I said, this is a little different. You know, you work this all the time. And every time you work it, you give your quarterback a different scenario. All right, you got a minute 30 left. You've got one timeout. We'd love a touchdown, but if we have to settle for a field goal, we will, just to get some momentum. You go through all of these things, and you don't have to be frantic about it.
Second down and 5. Little screen pass. This is Joseph. Gets a block. Down to the 10. Keith Joseph, the sophomore, 221-pounder, and bangs it down inside the 10, a pickup of 14.
Well, he's going to be right on that 10-yard line, and I think when they stretch out the sticks, I don't know that A&M's going to be able to get a first down. You almost want, as weird as this sounds, you almost don't want to get inside the 10, because first and goal from the 10 is a whole lot different than first and 10 from the 11, because you can pick up that first down.
I will tell you this, A&M has really been good in the red zone. scoring 90% of the time. 27 of 30 touchdowns. Throwing to the outside. Down to the five goes Terrence Thomas, and there's a flag.
Well, you can see why they brought Dustin Long in to be the starting quarterback for Mark Ferris.
Illegal shift on the offense. Oops. It's a five-yard penalty and remains first down.
Well, that's a big mental error by Texas A&M. Instead of second and goal from the four, they're going to have first and goal from the 15. But Dustin Long has plenty of arm. This is a long throw with extremely quick defensive backs. Watch how far Dustin Long, there's your illegal shift right there. Two men moving at the same time. But that's an extremely long throw by Long all the way back across the field.
First and goal. Long throws. Johnson. Intercepted. Oh, my, do you believe it? Pearson with the pick on the tip drill. It looked like it was a touchdown.
But boy, did he make a huge mistake. Why would he come out of the end zone?
He got a gift.
44 seconds left, two timeouts. Instead of the ball on the 20, they're going to have it on the 7-yard line.
His sixth interception, that's best in the Big 12.
Here he is right over, just coming over to make a play. Ball just slightly, and he should just put a knee down. Slightly underthrown.
What an interception.
Boy, you got to give part of that credit to Rod Babers, because that looked like a for sure touchdown to Bethel Johnson, but he was able to get a hand in there and break it up and pop it up to his teammate Pearson. But I still think Dakari Pearson made a mistake. He should have just gone down. And now Texas is just going to take a knee because of the horrible field position. There's no reason for Mac Brown to take a risk. If they're out on the 20, he might take a couple of shots.
It looked like to me that the side judge whistled him dead right here. When
no, he waved his arms. He waved his arms. I was listening for a whistle. You know what? I think the side judge expected that Pearson would go out of bounds.
Watch the official there.
But I never heard a whistle blow.
He was calling touchdown. Final seconds tick off of the first half. A well-played first half for the most part, but four turnovers for Texas A&M, and they have all been costly. Texas scored five of its six possessions and leads 23-7. Terrific first half by Chris Sims and the Texas Longhorns. Let's go downstairs. Here's Sam.
Oh, Coach, four huge turnovers, two big picks. Talk about your defense.
Well, our defense is playing great, Sam. We're still shorthanded like we were out at Texas Tech, but the guys are playing with a lot of confidence. Senior day, last time at home, 18 straight wins at home. Our offense has made some big plays, but this one's not over. We've played A&M every year, and the passion that kids have when they play football in this game and in this state's unbelievable.
Okay, Coach, thanks.
Thank you.
Tim.
All right, Mac, Sam, thank you. 23-7, Longhorns lead. Now let's join John Saunders and Terry Bowden at Times Square Stadium in New York City. Fellas.
All right, guys, thanks a lot. Chris Sims well on his way right now to becoming the first Texas quarterback with back-to-back 10-win seasons.
Yes, and as well as he's playing, Texas A&M is their own worst enemy. They've had four turnovers and given up two big pass plays.
All right, coming up is the Capital One Halftime Show. We're going to have a look at the Junction Boys movie that's ahead on ESPN. Also, some of the great radio calls of the season. All coming up after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
We are the proud and privileged guardians of a rare and priceless book called the Gutenberg Bible. And a longhorn named Bevo. Amen. We're Texas.
Rogers along the sideline, another one.
They're still in deep trouble at midfield. They tried to do a couple of... The ball is still loose as they get it to Rodgers. They give it back now to the 30. They're down to the 20. All the band is out on the field. He's going to go into the end zone. He's going into the end zone. Will it count? The Bears have scored, but the bands are out on the field. And the Bears have won. The Bears have won.
The trombone player still feeling that football in the back of his head. It's been 20 years since Joe Starkey had that unbelievable call, and it's hard to believe that that will ever be topped, although this year we came extremely close.
A 29-yard field goal put Kentucky up three with 11 seconds left and seemed to give the Wildcats the win. We have two calls, one from the LSU Sports Network, the other from UK Radio.
They're on the cusp. One of the biggest upsets in years. Final play of the game. Randall stops, throws it as far as he can. Caught, touchdown! Last play of the game, and I don't believe it. Holy cow! Oh my goodness.
Fans are up on the goalpost. I don't know why.
That's the most unbelievable inning I have. That is right up there, Tom, with the Stanford play. Stanford Cal return.
A 21-yard run by Auburn quarterback Jason Campbell had the Tiger fans thinking they'd put the Bulldogs on ice. But on 4th and 15, with a minute 25 left, Georgia had other thoughts. Here's 80-year-old Larry Munson.
Snap to David Green. There he goes in the corner again, and we jump up. Touchdown! Oh, God, a touchdown! Somebody went up high. Was it Watson or Gibson? Michael Johnson up high. We're trying to put glasses on it.
Furman took a 15-14 lead with 7.4 seconds left, with Billy Napier passing to Bear Reinhardt, and then decide to go for two? Here's the call from the Appalachian Sports Network.
Napier puts it out, pass picked off! Oh, here goes John Jeffries! Laterals to Derek Black! He's got to block somebody with it! Derek Black's going to go on the way! Woo-hoo! Derek Black's going to go! He's going to go! And he's going to go on the way! That's hard ASU! Touchdown Appalachian State! Yes. Oh, my God!
That will go down in history! We're going to get penalized here because, folks, our
who
players...
Cares?
USC type play back in the late 80s. Wow.
Big time celebration. Of course, it wasn't like the USC play. He really meant Cal and Stanford in the early 80s, not in the late 80s, but we'll give him that. And it also wasn't a touchdown. Yeah. It was 2 points. But Larry Munson, 80 years old or not, we need our glasses to find those touchdowns as well.
Yeah, nobody ever said Larry Munson had great eyesight, but he's the best announcer I've seen in the business.
All right, you're allowed to be a homer when you're a radio guy in college football. Thanks a lot, guys. We'll continue with more of the Capital One Halftime Show in just a moment from here in New York City and Times Square Stadium. Welcome back to Times Square Stadium. I'm John Saunders. A reminder, coming up at 3:30 Eastern Time, Colorado at Nebraska. It's been 12 years since the Buffs have won in Lincoln. For a preview, here's Brad Nestler.
Even with five losses, first time in over 40 years that's happened, John, they still know how to party in Lincoln, Nebraska. Getting ready for the Colorado Buffaloes today, and for the seventh straight year, they're the opponent to wrap up the regular season for Nebraska. Question mark for Chris Brown, number three rusher in the country. Will he play? We'll find out. Game time decision. Remember last year, 62-36, Colorado throttled the Cornhuskers, and Nebraska is looking for a little bit of revenge at home today. John?
And Brad, not just revenge, because this could make their season. When you have a down year like Nebraska has, a win like this would be huge.
Yes, but you know, Gary Barnett, he hasn't had a win in Lincoln, Nebraska. It's all going to change today.
All right, we will find out at 3:30 Eastern time. Texas A&M and Texas, let's get out to the second half.
Capacity crowd, Darrell K. Royal, Texas Memorial Stadium, being entertained by the University of Texas Band. Our presentation of college football will continue after this message and a word from our ABC stations. You're watching ABC Sports. Interesting.
4 News. When you want it, how you want it, where you want it. Como 4 News. Anytime, anywhere.
You're watching college football on ABC Sports. Championship Television.
Bevo getting ready for the second half. 4 turnovers by Texas A&M. And 10th-ranked Texas leads the Aggies 23-7. Welcome back, everybody. Tim Brand along with Ed Cunningham. Interesting first half, and it wasn't a 23-7 first half. Those 4 turnovers costly.
Well, Texas didn't take advantage of the turnovers, only 9 points on those. Chris Sims was great, though, with 2 touchdown passes. Derek Johnson got it started, a little hobbled by the hamstring. Big hit by Cedric Griffin, knocks the ball loose from Derek Farmer. And then it's a defensive back trying to play kick returner, getting a little sloppy with the ball. And then Ja'Cari Pearson, one-handed grab. Give a little credit to Rod Babers, who over there knocking it away. But Ja'Cari Pearson just made a sensational grab there at the end. And Dustin Long trying to make something happen. He's going to need to make something happen for A&M to get back in this ballgame.
R.C. Slocum, a 4-time coach of the year, now in his 14th year as head coach. Mack Brown in his 5th year at Texas. He's won 67 of his last 85 games. He's a perfect fit for Austin. Way, way back, and they'll bring it out to the 20. Vasher has no chance, so the touchback. Now let's take a look at the Pacific Life game summary.
The stats and the turnovers you would think would be the story of why the score was 23-7, but not really. Only 9 points off of those turnovers for Texas, 3 Dusty Mangum field goals, but 168 passing yards. And Chris Sims started 0-for-3 and then went on a tear. And him and Roy Williams are really, really in sync today. Williams already with a 75-yard touchdown catch.
You know, with all that speed Selvin Young has, love to see him return one of those kicks, at least have a chance, an opportunity to bring one out of the end zone. First down, Texas. Let's go downstairs. Here's Sam Ryan. Sam.
And Tim, I spoke with R.C. Slocum moments ago. He said the first half was very frustrating. He said it should be much closer, the score. They had 190 yards. Texas had 198 yards. But he said those 4 turnovers that you were talking about have been costly. They have to eliminate turnovers and continue to make big plays. Tim.
Couldn't agree with him more. You're right. We just talked about that. R.C. Slocum taking a lot of heat. College Station, Texas. And I want to tell you something. He's a quality coach. He's led the Aggies to 1 Big 12 title, 3 Southwest Conference crowns, 2 Big 12 South champions. He's everything college football should be. Get off his back. Second down, incomplete. It'll bring up third down, and this could be a good stop for A&M to start this half.
This is from about the first quarter. Early in the first quarter, the first pass that Chris has thrown that was really off the mark. I mean, not horribly off the mark. I'm splitting hairs here, as good as he played in that second quarter, but that one needs to be in near the body.
Third down and 9. Sims out of the gun. Backside pressure, steps up. He's not going to get away. Terrific defensive start for the Aggies.
Well, and even with all the injuries that we showed you earlier in the game, their entire secondary depleted. 6 of their top 8 defensive backs have spent time on the sidelines. 4 of them have never returned. The consistent thing that they've gotten all year is a great pass rush. And Jerod Penright, that we talked about in the open, he is such a diverse player, able to play on 2 feet, put his hand on the ground. He's a very explosive rush guy.
Penright leads the conference in sacks, so add another one. This is Johnson taking this punt at the 40. Good coverage by Texas. I mean, Michael Unger was all over him. A 42-yard punt, but only a 3-yard return.
Michael Unger, a walk-on, one of the special teams captains here, a senior playing his last game, and he's had a great career. 4 forced fumbles. He's recovered 4 of them. He plays that gunner. They list him as a wide receiver, but he's just a special teams guy.
How important is it here for the A&M offense to get out of the blocks in a hurry and get some points?
Oh, they have to get something going. I mean, this game in the second quarter started to look like a blowout. And Dustin Long threw the ball down the field efficiently. He just has to get rid of a couple of those interceptions or otherwise get a great first half.
Farmer gets around the corner to the 46-and-a-half-yard line, tripped up by Rod Babers.
And you can see why R.C. Slocum was upset about those turnovers. I mean, Dustin Long's playing a great game. He looks good in the pocket. You can take the one interception was just a great play by Rod Babers to be able to break up the look like a touchdown to Bethel Johnson. But Dustin Long's doing his part. Now they just need to clean up those turnovers.
Second down and six. Big hole. Look out. Farmer's loose. Inside the 30 to the 25-yard line goes Derek Farmer. He's been banged up, actually missed the Oklahoma State and Oklahoma games, but he's got five 100-yard games, and that's a pickup of 29.
Couple guys out front. You got your fullback leading all the way through is Keith Joseph. He gets a good block, and he's been running physical for a guy who's got a banged-up shoulder. Fumbled earlier in the game, and he's been taking the fight to Texas, and that looks like Dakari Pearson, who's down for Texas. You got cut block, and you know, as you're going towards the ball, you've got to look back. Even as you're looking towards the guy with the ball in his hands, you better peek. We all know what's been going on between Green Bay and Tampa Bay. You got to have your head on a swivel, regardless of where the ball is. Somebody might get you.
Long on first down. Audibilizes. Straight ahead they go, looking for a hole, goes Weber. You know, we talked to R.C. Slocum yesterday at some length, and we asked him, for those of us outside the state of Texas, tell us about this rivalry.
These towns in Texas really get into their high school football. The products of those teams and those programs are on each of these teams. Almost all of our players, almost all of their players are products of Texas high school football. Almost all of the fans in the stands will be from the state of Texas. And so, and the game's been going on for over 100 years. And that makes it special.
Special indeed on second and seven. Not much there. Inside the 20 goes Joe Weber.
Boy, Derek Johnson's not 100% today. He plays that weak side linebacker. And he went to take on the blocker, and he just doesn't line up right up here to the outside. He wrong arms it, drops his inside, his outside shoulder trying to take on that cut block, but he's usually athletic enough to move around a block like that and make the play.
I agree with you, but his penetration strung it out. Third down and five. It's up to Long now to make a play. Throws. He's got it complete at Porter. Porter's down close to the goal line. He'll mark it at the two. Gain of 11.
Look at the hands of Porter as he comes in motion. He had that catch against Oklahoma in the back of the end zone in the huge upset a few weeks ago. And it won't get much talk about the catch of the year, but he catches that ball. I mean, he caught the very end of that football as it was going through, and he was awfully close to getting in for six.
You know, he reminds me, looking at him on tape this past week, reminds me of Jeremy Shockey. First and goal. Touchdown, Texas A&M. Terrific catch by Terrence Murphy. Four catches now for Murphy, and A&M scores right out of the gates.
Down here at the bottom, just working one-on-one. The little fade stop. It looked like he was going to run a fade and then be very physical with his hands coming back. And we've seen every one of the A&M receivers and the tight end Porter make really tough catches, have to lay out and use great hands to bring it in.
Extra point attempt is good. And with 11:07 to play in the third period, Aggies with an impressive drive close the gap. It's 23-14, and Terrence Murphy is on fire.
For Texas A&M, back for Texas, number three, Sheldon Young.
Look at Dustin Long taking a break. He's got pretty good numbers today. 12 for 15, 149 yards, two touchdowns. Just tied the school record, but of course those two picks really helped the Longhorn.
Nice, Gary Kubiak. And he tied Gary Kubiak as we take a look at our Chrysler passing playbook. That's a lot of P's in there. But Terrence Murphy goes, it looks like he's running the fade, and Rod Babers gets to his outside and then right away comes back to the inside. Watch the move by Murphy as he uses his hands to get inside of Babers, and Babers just got too far to the outside. He thought fade the whole way, and Murphy did a really nice job of fighting back to the inside, but just not great body position by Babers.
Texas with 18 straight wins at home in a dogfight now. 11:01 to play in the third. Sims, first down, Texas. Three-step drop, throws it short, has it complete. A pickup of five. B.J. Johnson hit immediately after the catch. Sammy Davis, who was nicked up earlier, looks to be healthy again.
Given a little bit of cushion now because of what happened earlier, the 75-yard touchdown by Roy Williams, the 44-yard touchdown by B.J. Johnson. And Mike Hankwitz, the defensive coordinator, a little sick of seeing guys in burnt orange jerseys running by his guys in white.
After the mark, it sets up second down and six. Sims again. Same play. First down to the 35-yard line goes Roy Williams. His fifth catch of the game.
Well, and you're going to take what you got. And right now, A&M is playing way off of Roy Williams and B.J. Johnson. This is just a six-yard hitch. You got Appel, the free safety. He's got to be up around the line of scrimmage because of the running game threat with Cedric Benson and Selvin Young. And that starts to give you the room you need on the outside just to start dinking and dunking your way down the field.
Gain of 14. A&M, no question, concerned in their Texas quick strike ability, their big play capability. Want to keep everybody in front of them this half. Sims with a little longer drop this time, and overthrows, almost picked off, should have been by Jackson. Appel had it in his hands and came off his chest plate.
B.J. Johnson and Roy Williams were running mirrored routes, deep in cuts, and B.J. Johnson got smashed as he was coming out of his break, and that's why it looked like that ball was poorly thrown by Sims, but he was throwing it right on the spot where B.J. would have been if the defender had not run right into him.
There's a flag at the 45-yard line. Wait to see what that is. Appel was the, he was on the Aggie scout team last year as a redshirt and impressed the coaches so much. He's now the starting safety.
Pass interference, defense, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Well, R.C. Slocum was looking for an uncatchable ball, but B.J. Johnson was just not completely off of his route, so there's just no way that the officials could call uncatchable.
First down, Longhorns at the 47-yard line.
When the way Sims is playing, they've forgotten about the running game.
Here it is. Here's Benson. And Benson bulls his way down inside the 40. Gain of seven.
They knew they were getting a special player, Mack Brown, when they brought Cedric Benson in last year. True freshman. He didn't start till about the sixth game of the year because they had to bring him along a little slowly, learn the entire offense. But he was a three-time 5A. Player of the year in the state of Texas, and you heard RC talk about high school football in Texas. That's pretty darn impressive.
Talk about Long and how hot he is. Sims is 10 of 16. Texas just short of the first. Benson tripped up by Jasmine, but 10 of 16, 186 yards and two touchdowns for Sims. Pretty good ball game.
You know, it's funny, yesterday when we were talking to Chris about this ball game, and he admitted he was a little bit nervous. You know, his last game, he's so aware of the things that have been said about him by the fans here. And you know, you could sense he was a bit nervous that he really wanted to come out and just his last show at home, undefeated at home, go out on top. And he's really having a nice afternoon.
Three-step drop, really in a rhythm now. Throws complete to B.J. Johnson. You know, we were talking about the Aggies playing with a heavy heart today because of the death of Fails on Monday, but Texas, too. Texas has the same type situation with Cole Pittman. You know, the defensive tackle was killed in a car accident last year on his way to join teammates for spring drills. University of Texas has kept his locker intact, and it'll stay that way until his eligibility is up. He would have been a senior this year. His parents were introduced during the pregame ceremonies on senior day, so Texas can certainly empathize with what the Aggies are going through. Here's the give to Selden Young. Let's go down to Sam.
Well, Tim, joining me right now, it's Mark Pittman, Cole's father. A touching moment before the game. You were introduced along with the parents of the seniors. How did that make you feel to be part of that?
Oh, it makes us feel wonderfully special. Texas has just been unbelievable in supporting. In fact, we couldn't have made it through this ordeal without them.
Talk about the Cole Pittman Memorial Fund and what this money is going towards.
There were so many people that were touched by the death of this young man, and we've received thousands of letters and emails. We're building a field house to honor his name. And then any funds that are left over, we're going to scholarship inner city kids to Evangel Christian Academy, where Cole went to school. It's a private institution. There's kids, you know, some kids can't afford to go.
Now, A&M is dealing with an unfortunate tragedy of its own right now. I understand that you called Mr. and Mrs. Fails. What did you tell them, Mark?
Absolutely. And I talked to the Fails family, and my heart just cries for them. It doesn't matter what the outcome today's game is. Everybody loses because It's a tragedy that's just unbelievable, and I hope the state of Texas supports the Fails family the way they have supported us. And I've talked to Mr. Fails, and I think we're probably going to meet after he's had a couple weeks, and we're going to meet halfway from Freeport and Dallas and have a chance to sit down and talk so I can help him deal with the way I dealt with it.
Well, thank you, Mark.
Thank you.
Tim?
All right, Sam. Heavy week in Texas. As you look at his brother Chase, tell you this is another good stop here by the A&M defense, and it sets up another field goal attempt for Dusty Mangum. This will be a 43-yarder. He's 4 of 6 from this distance.
And A&M always very good at blocking kicks. They're overloaded to the left trying to get the push.
There you go. Aggies have it at the 47. Johnny Jolly with the block.
Boy, Johnny Jolly just absolutely split right through the middle. A lot of times you try to come down and build a wall, but Jolly did a great job of getting narrow. You turn your shoulders to the side and he got his big left hand up. And boy, the momentum is really starting to swing towards Texas A&M now.
Jolly with a huge play. 7:06 remaining in the third, but here come the Aggies.
Introducing the new 215 horsepower Chrysler PT Turbo.
Do you really think the bionic woman would beat the $6 million man in a foot race?
Yeah, she would. She was smaller, so she's more aerodynamic.
With lightning quick acceleration, you can go from 0 to 60 in the blink of a bionic eye.
6 mil. Yeah, now what was she? 3, 4.5 tops?
Guys, it was a TV show. They're not real.
Hold on, you know what I was thinking? What if they had a kid?
That'd be one fast kid.
PT Turbo. It'll really have you thinking fast.
ABC Sports presentation of college football is brought to you by Chrysler. Drive equals love. The people of Allstate. You're in good hands with Allstate. And by Sprint. Introducing PCS Vision. Clearly a whole new way to look at wireless. Gorgeous day in Austin, Texas. Clouds now starting to come in. Perfect day for football on a Thanksgiving weekend. Mack Brown knowing that the tide has turned slightly. The momentum has switched to the other side, and that man, R.C. Slocum. The quarterback is Dustin Long, and he's been on fire. Instead, he gives to Farmer. And Farmer has nowhere to run. He'll lose yardage. Dakari Pearson was there.
Great defense by the Longhorns.
Well, I said there was an overload to the left side. There are four Aggies lined up, and they're going to rush basically these two gaps. And the center, Leffler, the snapper, has to get over there and try to help his guard, Will Winston. And Jolly splits them. That's such tough duty when you're the snapper. You get through the ball, and then Leffler's got to actually come up and try to get over there to help. But Jolly just did a really nice job of turning sideways and getting his left hand extended.
Second down, and they need 14. They show blitz. They bring it with Griffin. They try to go over the top, and it's almost picked off. Pearson was going for the pick but was upended. Dangerous pass by Long.
Yeah, he laid this one up there, and it all started with Rod Babers. Boy, Babers struggled a little bit earlier. He gave up that touchdown to Murphy, but when he gets physical, he's such a confident cornerback, and he just jammed Bethel Johnson. And Johnson, a little payback. You know, usually those receivers are the ones who have to fly around and take shots that make them flip around.
Unenviable situation right now for the offense. Third and forever. Almost picked off again. Firing pick roll, got his hand on it. Love Brian pick roll.
Carl Reese's, Corey Redding looks a little banged up. Don't expect him not to be back in this game, but Carl Reese was talking about Brian Pickroll and said, this guy, he's 210 pounds, just a little, they call him the rubber band man. He never gets knocked off his feet. And he's just such an athletic guy, they have to have him on the field.
Cody Skates comes on to punt. He ranks ninth nationally, second in the conference. Averages well over 40 yards a punt. Vasher will look at this one inside the 10, fielded at the 5. Vasher taken down at the 14. So a 53-yard punt and a return of 9. But I mean to tell you, Cody Skates can some kind of boom the football. 5:56 to play the third. We've got a ball game.
These five.
11 yards shy of the record. Williams breaks a hole. Williams had a record book. Ricky Williams runs to the Hall of Fame. Cuts back. Ricky Williams, touchdown.
November 27th, 1998. Texas went on to beat A&M 26-24. Ricky Williams rushed for 259 yards to break Tony Dorsett's record. Terrific performance. First down, Texas. Selvin Young, the setback. Sims gives it to Young. Picks up 2. Marcus Jasmine makes the tackle. Jasmine, big guy, 317 pounds. Out of New Orleans, Louisiana. A hole clogger.
That run by Ricky Williams in that game in 98, the upset. Number 5 A&M. It might be my favorite play all time in college football. It just puts such an exclamation point on a Heisman Trophy campaign, a guy who so richly deserved that award.
Thomas and Johnson to the bottom of the screen. Williams to the top. Second down. Reload. They've got the first down. Thomas was tagged after the catch, but moved the chains.
There's been something in the water in Austin, Texas that has been affecting hamstrings during this season. Sloane Thomas, along with Roy Williams, a guy who has not been 100%, just sitting down on these routes, and with the space that Byron Jones and Sammy Davis in these corners are giving to these explosive wide receivers, Greg Davis is calling a very good game, being very patient.
First down for Sims. Strike to Thomas again. His third catch, and they move the ball to the 48-yard line. That'll bring some smiles.
Once again, just an inside release. This time, Sean Weston draws the tough duty. But I think an adjustment Mike Hankwitz has to, they just have to start taking a risk, and I think they've got to bring that cushion that they're giving these receivers, start playing a little more to the inside, because right now they're stealing candy from these guys.
Again, they fake the blitz. They throw to the outside. It's Thomas again. Three in a row for Thomas. Not enough for the first. He'll be 2 yards short, but they continue to move effectively, and Thomas is the hot receiver. Let's go down to Sam.
The guys joining me right now, straight from Hollywood, Matthew McConaughey, UT grad. Tell me about this rivalry, Aggies.
This is a great one. Yeah, this is one of the oldest and best ones in college football. I don't remember the last one I missed, and usually it goes as it's going now. We're up by 9, third quarter, 4 minutes left. Looks like we got a good game going all the way through the fourth quarter, but we should finish strong here and get us a little W.
More with Matthew in just a bit. Let's get the play, guys.
Matthew doing a play-by-play. Second down and 2. Young picks up the first. Let's go back to Matthew.
Matthew wants to do play-by-play. He was doing a little color down here also. Tell me a little bit about Thomas. What can you tell me about Thomas?
No, he has that one thing that great receivers have. He loves the ball. He knows that the ball is his friend. He follows the ball all the way to his hands every time. He's not afraid to take a hit. He's not afraid to go over the middle, take a big hit. He loves the ball.
Tell me about your new movie. What is it called?
It's called How to Lose a Guy in 10 Days, myself and Kate Hudson. It's a romantic comedy, and it works. And if any of you guys out there are afraid of romantic comedies, don't be afraid of this one. I stand up for the guys in this one. You have a good time.
Thank you, Matthew.
All right.
He looks dazed and confused.
First down and 10, Texas. Aggie defense not dazed, confused on that play. David Ross takes him down rather rudely. Ross, 270-pounder. Young, just 190.
Well,
and a flag.
Yeah, it came down. It looked like Robbie Doan and Gerard Penright were getting into it a little bit after the play.
Maintain your composure.
And the official on the far side came running in, making sure that it didn't get too heated.
Dip ball. Personal fouls on both teams. A wipeout.
That won't make the coaches happy.
Byron, come on, man.
Well, that's one of those no harm, no fouls. Personal foul, both of them jawing at each other. I think the officials just throw it to maintain control.
Cedric Benson comes back in for Texas on second down and 7. Benson taken down immediately by Randall Webb. Join ABC Sports tomorrow for outstanding regional action. At 1 Eastern, most of you will see Ken Dorsey lead the undefeated Hurricanes of Miami against Syracuse, or West Virginia against Pitt. Then at 8 Eastern, you'll see number 7 Notre Dame against number 6 USC in a game that is becoming huge. Florida State tomorrow on ABC Sports, right here, the class of college football.
And they're going to have to run that to 34 games. They still have Virginia Tech December 7th.
Third down and 10 for Sims. Did he pull it in? They say
yes,
he did. Inside the 30. Boy, Tony Jeffrey was bobbling it. Then evidently got possession before he went out.
Jeffrey, a former high school quarterback. Catches it not once, not twice, not the third time. Still fighting. Look
line.
At the body control.
His foot was on the line from that angle.
Now this will be a better angle to see.
Still bobbling it. Man, that's close.
Oh.
Guy was on the line, though. The official side judge was on the line. Better view than we did.
Let's see if he had control of it. I think that's the key. Watch this left foot. No, that's
inbounds.
He's dragging.
It's a good catch.
Boy,
good
that's
call.
A catch in the NFL, too.
Yep.
Drug that right foot.
Good catch, good call. But that's short. That much short of a first.
The crowd getting into it a little bit.
Well, that's Jeffrey's 11th catch of the year, but you wonder why he's not used more after a catch like that. That is special.
I got 3 reasons.
Yeah, you're
Sloan,
right.
Sloan, BJ, and Roy. Now this is crowds screaming for Mac to go for it. He's not going to take much thinking here. Absolutely. Jeffrey, who returned a block punt last year against Texas A&M to get the start on the scoring.
Texas had to take a timeout. Mack Brown's guys weren't ready. His field goal kicker, his punter, nobody was ready.
Well, it looked like they weren't. It doesn't look like there was going to be any decision. It looked like they were going to go for it all the way. I don't know why there would be that much confusion.
2:04 to play in the third. You see the timeouts remaining.
Well, you mentioned earlier R.C. Slocum, all the heat that he's been taking. Dennis Franchione has been mentioned, and a lot of people say that they've had discussions. You know, when you look at this and the people that R.C. Slocum is in the company of since 1990, I have no clue in the world how you could say R.C. Slocum, with all that he's been through, with all the injuries and everything this year, his job is in jeopardy. I think that's ridiculous.
Well, the man can coach 11 bowls in his 14 years. They're bowl eligible again. But beyond that, he's everything good in college football.
That's a pretty good guy right there, too. Both of these men, they're close friends. One of the first guys that R.C. Slocum called when he found out that Brandon Fales had passed away was Mack Brown, so that Mack knew when he went to his press conference how to talk to the press. It was a very classy move on Coach Slocum's part.
You'd be lucky to have your son play for either one of them. Fourth down and short, the give, the hold. See you later. Cedric Benson, touchdown Texas, a flag down in the backfield.
A&M offsides.
Just an explosion by Cedric Benson, and it's declined by the Longhorns. A 30-yard touchdown. His 11th of the year. And the former Texas High School Player of the Year has excited this crowd. Add one more, and it's 30-14 Texas.
Well, you got Matt Trissel playing in his last ball game at the fullback spot right here. He is a sensational blocker. He hasn't run the ball one time this year, but as the linebacker came up to fill, Trissel just absolutely buries him. And Benson had the easy part. All the hard work was done. That hole just opened. There's nobody in the screen in that hole.
What a great block by Brock Edwards. Actually took two guys out of the play. Watch the right end.
Woo. Oh, yes, he absolutely
sealed him off and turned him out.
Yeah, that's the whole key. You don't always have to move them vertically. It's just as important to move them horizontally down the line.
You know, when you talk to Cedric Benson, as you look at his numbers, his hero growing up was Barry Sanders, but he says the biggest influence on his football career was Ricky Williams, and he continues to move up the charts.
Biggest influence on his hairdo as well. Boy, but you're right. Brock Edwards and Matt Trissel made that play go. Edwards knocked his guy 4 yards off the ball.
Carter at the 10.
Jason Carter with a nice return brings it out to the 34-yard line. Tomorrow, Tiger Woods, Phil Mickelson, Marco Mira, and Fred Couples compete for $1 million in a Thanksgiving weekend classic. The ConAgra Food Skins Game. Tomorrow at 4:30 Eastern, 1:30 Pacific, right here on ABC.
Did you say $1 million?
Sir.
That Skins Game just keeps growing and growing.
The way you play, I wish that's what we played for.
50 cents, I need 5 strokes aside.
Well, the Aggies have to get something going in a hurry. They're being left behind. Here's Weber. Speaking about being left behind, he loses yardage. Michael Huff, the safety, came out I mean, just like a shot up to make the tackle.
Well, this defense, one of the top defenses in the nation last year, one of the top defenses in the nation this year, and it is downright scary. I mean, they lose Corey Redding, and they lose Rod Babers. But other than that,
well, this defense,
most of this defense, first and second string, returns next year.
This defense has posted three shutouts this year. Only team to do that in college football Division I-A. Here's the pass to Murphy, and that's complete. First down, his fifth catch. Really been the hot receiver today.
This is a really good crew of receivers. Nathan Vasher playing in his zone. He's got underneath. Just find that little spot in there. And A&M's been able to move the ball. Just little mistakes. They've hurt themselves. All those turnovers early. But Kevin Sumlin, the wide receivers coach and the play call, he's called a pretty good ball game.
This is Farmer. Across midfield into Texas territory. Again, Michael Huff is there to make the tackle. Very talented safety, but Farmer slipped through a hole that didn't exist.
He's got that little burst, doesn't he? He had the really bad hyperextended knee last year. His shoulder's been bothering him all season long. He missed two ball games and most of the Missouri game. But he can really, once he finds that little seam, he gets in it awfully quick.
On second down, long throws complete to Terrence Thomas, but he's not going to have enough for the first. He gets a pretty good mark, but should be about a yard short. Actually gets a great mark. He's close. Good pressure that time by Corey Redding on long, but he still got a strike off.
You know, from this angle, it doesn't look like he's got it. And if I'm R.C. Slocum, and if I'm talking to Kevin Sumlin, the offensive coordinator, if we don't pick this up, I think it's take a shot time, third and short, because you're on the positive side of the field. It's 30-14. This is that part of the game where you've got to start thinking about taking some risks.
That far.
You know, you can pack everybody in, and they have a weapon in Greg Porter, their tight end, to pack everybody in, then slip him out late and see if you can't find him down the seam. I think this might be a good time in the game to go ahead and take a big risk. And it is a big risk, because if you don't get it, then you've got fourth down right around midfield.
Well, here we go. They go with heavy formation. Send Taylor to the top of the screen and Bethel Johnson to the bottom. Out of the eye, right side. Oh, I don't know.
Wow.
Joe Weber got up to the line of scrimmage and then got tattooed.
Boy, he did get nailed, didn't he? He had that forward momentum, and then it just came to a dead stop.
I've always been a believer when the ball is that close to the goal line or to a first down, don't
straight
ever
ahead.
Take it backwards.
Yep. Don't go lateral.
Quarterback
Absolutely.
Sneaks straight ahead.
Or a fullback dive. Don't try to do anything laterally.
Didn't gain an inch.
You know what? I got to go if I'm R.C. Slocum. I don't want to pump the ball away to Texas because of what they've been doing offensively. And as hot as Sims is, just pound it straight ahead, just like you said. Get the fullback going, maybe a quarterback sneak or something. But
well, and the quarterback has that ability to go to the right cheek or the left cheek off that center, wherever there's a little gap.
The quarterback cheek.
All right, enough horseplay. It's fourth down and short. The end of the third period. Our presentation of college football will continue after this message and a word from our ABC stations. You're watching ABC Sports, deep in the heart of Texas. Another log on
fire. We're all set for the final 15. 30 to 14, Texas. Fourth down and short for the Aggies. Quarterback sneak. He should have it depending on the mark, and it looks like they're going to give him the proper mark. Or will they?
Well,
they had,
you,
it. They had him on the 45, and then they moved it back.
Boy, the linesman came in, and I didn't like where he put his foot down.
Oh, he didn't get a good mark
at
all.
No, not at all. Boy, it really looked like the surge of that offensive line was plenty to pick up the first down.
That's unbelievable.
I still think he got it, though.
Side judge actually ran down the line like that, and when got near the ball, moved inside the line.
Yeah, it looked like he was going to put his foot right on the stripe.
This is going to be close.
It up. I think he got it.
I don't know. I mean, just barely.
The Longhorns defense started celebrating.
Look at RC.
OJ McClintock's out there. He started going nuts. It looks to me from right away that they got it. Well, I don't know. Maybe that was the right spot. He didn't extend that ball all the way out to the 45-yard line.
See the time remaining in the game. Aggies need to score badly.
Now the right tackle flinched. Alan Ruber. When you're 6'6", 302, there's no hiding. There's no
prior
hiding
to the snap.
Football.
False start on the offense. It'll be a 5-yard penalty and remain first down.
With the four turnovers combined with the penalties, it has really slowed this offense down. In the last eight games, Texas A&M had really caught fire, averaging 34 points a game, but this kind of thing today has kept them to 14.
Well, he did the Texas one step. Ruber just dropped that right foot back in anticipation of the snap count, trying to get out of his stance. The pass block and got nabbed.
Problem was the music hadn't started. First down, A&M. Long loses the ball. Texas has it.
Trifecta for Corey Redding. Sack, strip, and fumble recovery.
He's the defensive leader and the senior who heads up that big D.
Boy, and it's just, he's been playing so relentlessly the last 6 weeks. Drops his inside shoulder, Taylor Whitley, and you always go with the outside arm. When you're a defensive lineman, you don't reach with the inside arm. You reach over the top with the outside arm, extend, slap at the ball, and then, hey, look at that. Early Christmas present for me. Great play by Redding.
First down, Texas. Play action. Trying to make them pay right away. Wide open. Williams, touchdown, Texas. Roy Williams, 38-yard strike. His second touchdown of the afternoon. Hugging Corey Redding, saying that touchdown belongs to you.
Well, I understand why Mac Brown's going for two with the number, but this point in the game, I think maybe you just kicked the extra point. The chart, the two-point chart tells you at this point you want to be up 38 to 14, but I still think you just let Dusty Mangum kick it.
Benson in motion. Sims looks underneath. Incomplete. Sims, 16 for 23, 278 yards and three touchdowns, told us last night his best games have been against Texas A&M. He's not a Texan by birth, but I'll tell you this, he understands the rivalry. Right now, he's leading the Longhorns to the promised land. Taking a commanding lead, 36 to 14. It's time to go Hollywood.
Who said actors aren't smart? Go hang out with the cheerleaders.
Touchback, bring it out to the 20.
Well, new school record for Roy Williams. Single season receiving touchdowns. Passed Herky Walls from the early 80s. And him and Chris Sims have made it look easy today. Sammy Davis squatting in zone coverage, passes off, expecting help from his safety, Jackson Appel. And Roy Williams runs right by him. And the reason that Appel was up near the line of scrimmage, he got sucked in on a play fake and never got back into his coverage.
Like going bear hunting with a stick. First down, Aggies. Intercepted. Michael Huff. See you later. Texas leads the Big 12, ranks eighth in the country in pass defense, and now you can see why. Extra point is good. .53 to play, and it's 43-14, and Texas has busted this one wide open.
Defensive secondary for Texas is so good and so deep. Michael Huff, a backup safety, and that ball came out awful wobbly because Dustin Long was getting knocked to the ground right as he let it go. And how many balls have we seen today that get tapped around? We saw Tony Jeffrey do it a little while ago on offense, but Huff and Dakari Pearson, balls floating around in the air, make really good plays, just doing the old tip drill, but both those guys tipped it to themselves.
What a break he got on the ball. He was watching the eyes of Texas
the whole
A&M.
Way. Oh, yes, he was. I just got your play on words. Sorry.
Six turnovers for the Aggies, three interceptions and three fumbles. Another deep kick that will go out of the end zone for a touchback. They'll bring it into the 20. At the conclusion of today's game, we will select a Chevrolet player of the game, as we always do. Chevrolet will make a $1,000 contribution to each university's general scholarship fund. I mean this in a positive way. Texas carries itself boldly, self-assuredly, almost brash and cocky. They know they're Texas. They know they're tough. And today, just making Texas A&M pay.
Well, and the thing that's going to happen in the next couple of years with the talent that Mack Brown and his staff continue to bring in, they're going to get over that hump. They're going to get over the Oklahoma hump. They're going to get over the hump of winning the big games, tough games on the road. It's just bound to happen. And then it's going to be conference championship on top of conference championship, and they're going to be in the national title hunt every year for a long time.
Coming up next, Big 12 North champs Colorado take on Jamal Lord and the Huskers, who are out to avenge last year's loss. That's coming up next right here on ABC Sports, the class of college football. So get out the leftovers, keep that fire roaring, settle in for what should be a pretty good ball game.
Boy, and you got to think Nebraska would like a little bit of revenge after what Colorado did to them last year.
Second down and 7. Sacked. Lee Jackson with his 5th sack of the year.
Lee Jackson, who played strong safety his first 3 years here, put on a little bit of weight this offseason. He missed the better part of 2 years. Coming on the outside blitz. And Ruber just not fast enough to keep up with the former safety, runs right by him. senior having a nice, making a big play on his last game at home.
Coming with the blitz, throwing up top and out of bounds. You feel so much empathy, not only for Dustin Long, but everybody on that Texas A&M sideline. The death of a teammate on Monday, knowing you have to come play your rival. Tomorrow is the funeral for Brandon Fales, the young 18-year-old defensive lineman who passed away Monday. It's just a very difficult time for the Aggies.
They've got nothing to be embarrassed about, though. They're playing a very hot Texas team. They came out, they've come out with great effort. Just the ball is too many turnovers, too many big plays for Texas defensively.
So once again, Texas will start with great field position after a 27-yard punt. They'll have it in Aggie territory. 12-11 still to play. I don't blame you right now. They're starting to put you to sleep. Texas scoring all these points. A&M trying to climb back in, but running out of time. 12-11 to play. And Longhorn fans know that Texas has extended this thing to 43-14, and R.C. Slocum is up against it. Short field for Sims once again. First down at the 45. Cedric Benson off the right side picks up a yard.
32 Cedric Benson on carry.
ABC Sports presentation of college football is brought to you by Chevy Trucks, the most dependable, longest lasting trucks on the road. By AIG Insurance, financial services and the freedom to dare. And by Pepsi Blue, a fusion of berries with a splash of cola. It's a blue thing. Even Bevo looks a little bit tired and bored right now.
He could use a shot of that caffeine.
Cedric Benson. Another tough yard. Marcus Jasmine makes the tackle along with Archie McDaniel.
Boy, Chris Sims has really been efficient with the ball today, and you look how he's distributed the ball around. Really, not a whole lot of stuff open back deep for Chris Sims because of the way Texas A&M has been playing. So what he's been doing is coming right through here, and those two touchdowns on the slant and then the drag, 16 of 23, 278 yards and three touchdowns. He's been great since a slow start.
Third down for Sims. He rolls for time, throws incomplete. Well, a lot of action on that play. And
yeah, and Sloan Thomas took a shot to his elbow as Sammy Davis converged on him.
Boy, there was pressure in the backfield, then watching the DBs and the receivers get tied up together.
Looked like he took a Sammy Davis flying in there. It looked like his helmet hit right on the forearm of Sloan Thomas.
Low snap, little pooch punt. Jason Carter tells everybody to get away from this one, and it rolls inside the five. Touchback.
Yeah, it broke.
Bring it out to the 20.
It's our guy Michael Unger trying to make a play.
Crowd wasn't happy about that. A 41-yard punt. They thought he had saved it and downed it inside the one. .10-29 to play. Right now, it's all Longhorns. The Aggies got a break there. Great day for the seniors. 15 seniors are the most successful group of Aggies since the Dat Wynn Group, 1998, which won the Big 12 crown. But they're going to go down in defeat here today to the Longhorn senior pack.
Now we'll take a look at the Pacific Life game summary. Things were looking pretty good when Terrence Murphy hauled in this touchdown, and then Cedric Benson runs through a gaping hole. And then Roy Williams runs right by the free safety, Jackson Abell. Chris Sims having a wonderful day. And then, of course, the defense wants to get involved as Michael Huff tip-taps one to himself and strolls on in for seven.
All the seniors contributing big today. Long has the completion, but Terrence Thomas not sure that it was worth it. Pick up 4 yards.
3 yards at the play.
I wonder if he's got that bumper sticker, Chris Sims, that says, I wasn't born in Texas, but I got here as fast as I could.
Only 3 of 9 on third down conversions today. Third down and 7 for A&M. Outside they go to Greg Porter, short of the first down. Talked about a lot of the distractions and certainly the death of Brandon Fales earlier in the week. But also a distraction has been all the talk about R.C. Slocum's future, and I asked him about the rumors of a coaching change.
To vent their frustrations in ways that aren't always supportive or positive. Coaches know how that works, and in this business, if you listen to everything that's said about you, you'd be a miserable person, and you'd certainly be in the wrong business.
Vasher on the return of a punt just adds to the aggravation and speculation. A 60-yard punt return for a touchdown, and it doesn't get better for R.C. Slocum. Wow.
Wow is right, and that's the first punt return for a touchdown since about middle of the year for Nathan Vasher. He was an all Big 12 return man because he was so good. He had a bad ankle. He hurt it against UNC, banged it up a little bit again last week against Texas Tech. He found the wall, and it was bye-bye awfully quickly.
Prior to the snap, delay
of game by Texas
penalty.
Moves him back.
Try.
That's one thing that has improved drastically for Mac Brown and his staff in the last 3 years is their special teams. And a lot of it has to do with big explosive plays like that. He has regular players on his defense and offense, guys who start, who now request to be a part of special teams because of big plays like that and the excitement that they bring.
Boy, he is just automatic with PATs. Hasn't missed one this year.
Well, when you got a wall set up, you got to get to it as a punt returner. Nathan Vasher, a good punt. Overrun, a couple of guys from Texas A&M. You work all the time about coming to balance, getting over the whole part of your foot, not up on the balls when you get near a guy like Nathan Vasher. And he made a couple of guys missed early. Brian Singleton runs right by him, and there is the wall completely set up, and he gets a couple of nice blocks, one by Richard Hightower. Looked like a knockout block. And once you get to that wall, you got guys out in front of you, including Bo Trahan, who's a holder, special teams ace.
You know, Brown. We talked about Vasher earlier. We said, boy, wouldn't it be nice to see him get a chance at least to return.
Mm-hmm.
Very confident and gifted athlete. One of the nation's best, certainly at corner cover. 7 interceptions last year, 4 picks this year. And as a return guy, you can see his burst. You can see the speed that he possesses.
I had 7 interceptions last year playing that free safety spot. And then when Quentin Jammer left, going to the NFL, Vasher went back to his more normal spot of corner. But Carl Reitz, the defensive coordinator, always likes to have what he calls 4 corners in his secondary at all times.
Jason Carter decides to down it. He'll bring it out to the 20.27 straight points by Texas. And if they had it, right now would be the time to execute it, the mercy rule.
You know that the University of Texas is undefeated when they outscore their opponents?
And you were an academic All-American. Oh, my.
I figured that one out all by myself.
Oh, my. Farmer still trying. He is tagged at the end of the run.
Well, now you can start getting these guys in that don't get to play a whole lot. And that's Kendall Briles in there. Freshman out of Lubbock, Texas. His father, Art, actually coaches at Texas Tech. He's going to lay the wood to somebody when he gets a chance. Farmer's run so hard today. But watch this right at the end.
Larry Dibbles also checks in now at defensive tackle. He's a big young kid. Second down for Dustin Long. Looking deep. Throws. Has the completion to Terrence Thomas up near midfield. So that's a first down and a pickup of 22.
You know, both of these schools are going to have great competition at the quarterback spot come spring ball. With the graduation of Chris Sims, you're going to have Vincent Young, a highly touted recruit out of Houston, Texas, who's redshirting this year, battling Chance Mock, who I think has a real bright future. And Dustin Long's going to have great competition with Reggie McNeil, who unfortunately suffered that ankle sprain last week against Missouri. We would have seen him in the starting role today.
Well, it's interesting the way this thing started. As Farmer has a big hole and busted out across the 40 for the first. But Texas A&M started the year with 27-year-old Mark Ferris as the quarterback. And as you mentioned, Reggie McNeil, the true freshman, certainly has had his opportunities this year. And then in between comes Dustin Long, who has just a rifle hanging from his shoulder. And he's only a sophomore. His first career start was September 21st against Virginia Tech. And then he went and set that school record against Kansas. And 399 yards and the 7 touchdowns he had against Texas Tech, both school records.
And, you know, through all of this, Mark Ferris has been an unbelievable teammate. Both of these young quarterbacks talk about Ferris being like an uncle. He just constantly helping them with their reads and figuring out this offense. He's been fantastic through a very difficult senior year.
Another first down for A&M. 6:54 remaining in the ball game. There goes Dibbles. Look at Larry Dibbles, and he wears number 1. Big defensive tackle. You talk about 1 being the loneliest number. That number looks minuscule on his big body.
And when you go recruit linemen, or when NFL scouts are looking at linemen, the first part of their body they look at is the rear end.
He's 6'4", 290.
He's gifted in the back door department.
Fleming with his first carry gets back to the line of scrimmage, and then he's tagged by Derek Johnson. Very unusual to see a defensive tackle wear a number 1.
He better play well when he gets his chance to be a regular down guy. He better bring it pretty strong if you're going to be drawing that much attention to yourself.
This game played for so many years on Thanksgiving Day and recent years on Thanksgiving Friday, but truly one of the great traditions in college football. A&M in Texas. Here goes Dustin Long now.
Oh,
inside the 15.
Oh, he got stung by Reed Boyd.
Boyd, a 6'3", 235-pound junior. You know, Boyd was the backup linebacker to D.D. Lewis. Now he's the man.
And Dustin Long's punch drunk right now. He's leaning over. Watch this shot right to the side of his head from Boyd. Spun him around, actually hit him right up around the shoulder. But boy, Dustin Long, he's a little gimpy right now.
Gonna try to, I think the officials are gonna make him go out of play.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, it looked like his left leg got a little caught under him, too.
So he will go out for a play, and Jason Carter comes in. Jason Carter, a 6 foot 190-pound sophomore from Caldwell, Texas, has not had much playing time at all.
Wonder why Mark Ferris wouldn't come into the game, the senior we were just talking about.
Here's pressure. They've lost a yard.
I know you want to get some young guys some playing time, but a guy like Mark Ferris, who has been so good for your program, threw for over 2,500 yards as a sophomore, set the all-time single-season record for A&M. And Dustin looks awfully banged up.
So they leave Jason Carter in again. It'll be fourth down for the Aggies. They need four. The young quarterback's up against it. He's going to be looking for number 44. Avoids the rush. Takes it around the corner. Has the first. And scores a touchdown. How about that? Jason Carter comes into the ball game and makes a spectacular play. 15-yard touchdown run. RC tried to get him back on the field for two. Now that was pretty impressive. Yeah. He showed a burst around that corner.
Yeah, he sure did.
And then a great effort to go over the top into the end zone.
Well, no wonder they had him in the game. I was thinking Ferris would come in the senior, but obviously Carter has just a little bit of athletic ability.
Terrific effort down that sidelines, especially at the goal line. He's young, got a spring in those legs, and a healthy body. Fleming's the setback, going for the two-point conversion. Carter throws to the corner, and incomplete.
Well, that's a tough throw to have a guy who's been standing on the sideline, barely played at all this year. You've got to make the perfect fade throw. I would have, with his athletic ability, moved him out of the pocket.
But what a great effort by the youngster to get around the corner first. Stay inbound second, and then leap for the touchdown third. 8 in 1977, who was the running back? Earl Campbell, that's who. Rushed for 222 yards and four touchdowns. Texas earned a trip to the Cotton Bowl and the league title with a victory against the Aggies. But what a day. 222 yards, four scores for Earl Campbell, November 26th, 1977. .413 remaining in a ball game that is similar here.
Timeout.
Horns lead
Texas.
50 to 20 over the Aggies.
Well, and A&M came out with their onside kick alignment, and Texas didn't have its hands group in. So Mac Brown has to call a timeout to get the right folks in.
Strange game in that the Aggies really played well, straight up with Texas in the first half, but the turnovers were costly, and Texas turned them into points. Second half, though, talent has really taken over for the Longhorns.
Well, and when you let Chris Sims get into a rhythm like he did midway through that second quarter, you are in trouble. And every team that's ever had success against Sims has gotten him off his rhythm, and he's been really able to set his feet and throw today.
The party has begun in Austin. And you can bet 6th Street will be hopping tonight. Chris Sims and the Aggies still hoping for an at-large berth to the BCS. The teams that are being considered for that at-large, by the way, and there are two at-large positions, Iowa, Kansas State, Notre Dame, and Texas.
Yeah, I don't think they have much of a shot. I mean, I know they're in the mix, but you got to assume Notre Dame gets one, Iowa gets one to the Rose Bowl. And we were talking earlier, USC sitting out there as a two-loss team, playing as good as anybody in the country.
Let's take you to New York. John Saunders, John. 4:08 remaining in the ball game. The Longhorns with the football and the score in their favor. Cedric Benson busted big out to the 34-yard line, close to a first, yard short. It'll bring up second down and one. Let's go down to Sam.
Well, Tim, you've been talking about the seniors. Well, fourth to the seniors today marks the end of the road for several Longhorn players. For the 24 seniors, this is their last home game with Texas football. Now, prior to the game, the school honored its senior players along with their families. They were introduced before the crowd, just one of the many memories the seniors will take with them. Chris Sims told me one of his most exciting memories was his freshman year. He got to make his first career start against Texas A&M at College Station. 4 years later, his last start at home, A&M again.
Whistle stops play, and Sam, as you're giving that report, fairly emotional as the crowd takes to its feet and gives a great round of applause to Chris Sims
offense,
as he comes out.
It'll be a 5-yard
final game here in
the
stadium.
Down.
25-6 as a starter now. He was the high school player of the year. As a sophomore, he led the conference in passing efficiency. As a junior, he threw 22 touchdowns and ran for 6. And now he ranks first here at Texas in career completion percentage, most accurate passer to ever play at the University of Texas.
And by all rights, should be a redshirt junior this year. Sam mentioned that he made that start against Texas A&M back in 1999. The only reason he had to play was the backup quarterback that year behind Major Applewhite was a minor league baseball player and decided to pack his bags and go try his chances in the farm system. And Sims came here expecting the redshirt and was never able to do that.
You know, it was pretty interesting. They asked him how he wanted to be remembered. He deviated from football and just said, I want to be remembered as a nice guy, a guy who kept things in perspective.
So much has been written about his shortcomings in some big games, and the team hasn't always played great, but let me tell you, there's no better guy than Chris Sims, especially as a teammate.
Time permitting, stay tuned for the Thrifty Car Rental postgame report. John and Terry will have scores and highlights from around the country. Two of the hardest working guys in showbiz. Selvin Young, the ball carrier. You know, his dad went through a similar situation. Phil Sims, of course, battled Scott Bruner and Jeff Hostetler. And Chris here at Texas had to Major Applewhite all the way through. Still perhaps the most popular guy here is Major Applewhite.
Well, you go back to last year when everybody was saying Applewhite should be the starter, and Major played so well when it came in, but a lot of people didn't realize how bad Major Applewhite's knees were after all of those surgeries and everything else. I doubt Major Applewhite would have been able to make it through an entire year. That's one of the biggest reasons that he decided to leave New England before training camp, trying to make the NFL, is because of his health.
Just melting the clock now and having fun doing it. 1:45 to play. Well, the executive producer of ABC Sports is Howard Katz. Senior producer of ABC Sports, Bob Toms. Coordinating producer of college football is Bobby Goodrich. Today's game produced by Chris Pfeiffer. Directed by David Kiviat. Associate producer Chris Watt. Associate director Dick Ellis. Our studio show produced by Tim Weinkauf and directed by Calvin Haywood. The TD, Kevin Berman. Or Bierman, rather. I'm sorry, Kevin. Our technical director is Beth Tura. Assistant to the producer Kirk Thomas and Tom Self. And director of production is Mark Loomis. Kudos to all on this Thanksgiving weekend.
Well, you could sense Chris Sims' nervousness yesterday when we talked to him about wanting to go out on top. And the talk around town this week has been, we've been hard on Sims for a long time. Let's be supportive of him today. And he gave them a lot to support.
Texas Longhorns will go to 10-2, 6-2 in the conference. Put themselves in position not only to win the conference, but also to put themselves in the national title picture. And then we're upset by Texas Tech in a shootout. As emotions begin to flare, Mac Brown was telling us this is a game of respect. But you can't take away the emotions. Final 13 seconds ticking away.
Chris Sims going right to R.C. Slocum. Slocum in the past has been so supportive of Sims and called him several times and told him hang in there at all costs.
That's it. Texas wins it 50-20. Today's Chevrolet Players of the Game. Chris Sims, spectacular day. 16-24, three touchdowns. Gerard Penright, three tackles and two sacks for A&M. In recognition of their efforts, Chevrolet will make a $1,000 contribution to each university's general scholarship fund. Well, they call it a backyard brawl, but it's more like a protection of pride and a soul-searching spirit. This game is special. Everybody in Texas understands it. They love it. And the Longhorns walk away with a big win today, 50-20 over the Aggies. ABC Sports is online at ESPN.com. Keyword, ABC Sports. Coming up next, our college football doubleheader continues as Big 12 North champs Colorado take on Nebraska. For Ed Cunningham and Sam Ryan, I'm Tim Brandt saying so long from the University of Texas campus in Austin, Texas. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody.